Well, the first 3 days of the Giro d'Italia, Phil, are actually on the island of Sicily, where the World Championships was in 1994. And I can tell you one thing, it's pretty hot down there to race in.
Well, it's absolutely beautiful. The first stage, 175 kilometres, and I would think, Paul, the riders aren't going to want to do much more than that in heat like this. This is the famous Valley of the Temples here, and not far away from the scene of the World Championships a few years ago.
And on that occasion, it was Luc Leblanc who took the title to France ahead of Richard Virenque in third place, a real dominant performance by the French.
Well, the Seiko boys at the front here trying again to control the race because, remember, Mario Cipollini, 25 stage wins, which is a post-war record, and he's still trying to build on that too. But he has been on the floor already, a puncture, in fact, at the feed zone, but he's back in the field, although the field looks slightly reduced. Although the pace, Paul, at only 36 kilometres an hour is slow, the heat at nearly 35 degrees Celsius has taken its toll on the field today.
This is a very hot part of Italy down here, and that was the major problem when the World Championships were here in 1994. Many of the riders suffering from the heat, but these two guys certainly not. They've gone out to try and steal a margin over the rest. After 95 kilometres, they broke away from the main field. This is Massimo Apollonio, who's on the front at the moment, and with him is Paolo Valotti. Neither of these riders big winners, but they're hoping to surprise everybody in the first stage of the Giro.
Well, they slipped off the front when there was a little bit of confusion in the feed zone at the back with Cipollini and another rider who fell down. But look at this now. If you don't have a head for heights, you better turn away, because there's no way if you have a shunt here, it's a long way down to the bottom. But the field, you see, under pressure again, is splitting up. This has been a very interesting first stage, actually.
Inside 1 kilometre to go, the main field always controlled by the red squad of Mario Cipollini. Cipollini there currently in second position, but he's going to get challenged by Jeroen Blijlevens, who's in pretty good condition so far this season. But Blijlevens, for the moment, a little bit too far down there in 10th place.
Indeed he is, and the Seiko boys again seem to have control of this, but Cipollini now trying to take this one, but he's being rushed all of the way here, and this is Blijlevens and Caranta who's challenging him. Well, that is amazing, because they've really forced their way through the pack here. Now Cipollini, with 25 stage wins already in the Giro d'Italia, thought that this one might be a little bit easy for him. The time has been slow all day. The sprinters now deciding to have a go for it. The Navigare team leading out for the line there now as the field strings out here in Madrid. Now looking down, Cipollini on the far right as they cross the line. Well, that was Yvon Caranta who took it for Movilvetta North Wave. Now watch this, because this is a little bit of a blow to Cipollini, because Caranta, taking his sixth win of the season, is going to be delighted at having beaten Cipollini and Jeroen Blijlevens.
That's an incredible sprint there. Cipollini never really looked as if he was in the game. He was in the wrong place all of the time. And this young man, Ivan Quaranta, has won a lot of races so far this year, Phil, but this is certainly his biggest win.
Well, he's come to the tour here, and he's done it on day one, taking the first blood for Italy and also, of course, beating the Lion King, Mario Cipollini. So it's looking good for the sprinters after day one in the Giro d'Italia, but the hills aren't far away this year.
A very short stage, the second stage, Noto to Catania, where they had the time trials at the World Championships. 133 kilometres, and again, a sprinter's dream.
Indeed. By the way, two riders not in this sprint, Javier Ochoa Palacios and Nicola Loda, not allowed to start the Giro because of too high a hematocrit level, so they would decide it wasn't healthy for them to ride at all. Now looking down, just look at this, Paul. There's barging going on and pushing here. This is Andrea Leone, and he seems to be pushing the Russian champion Sergei Ivanov, and he's getting a rough ride.
Well, Ivanov is trying to get onto the wheel of Blijlevens. They're on the same team. All the top sprinters try and have a sweeper on their back wheel to stop somebody coming off their wheel once the sprint starts. Ivanov is trying to stay behind Blijlevens in the mauve jersey, and that's why Leone is banging up alongside him. Now, this is unbelievable.
That's unbelievable. Well, if the referees are seeing this, he's definitely going to be disqualified to the back of the field. And Sergei Ivanov is, he's no slouch when it comes to throwing his weight around, and he's going to hold that wheel, and he's still got Blijlevens' wheel. Blijlevens on the tail of the Seiko Cannondale train here. Remember, Cipollini only third yesterday, still smarting over that. Well, his team are trying to make amends now. They've got all of the lead-out men at the front, including Giammatteo Fanini, as they line up towards the finish here now. And this looks like a perfect finish for the rider in number three position. But in the intergiro jersey, that mauve jersey, that is Jeroen Blijlevens, who's also looking for the stage win here. But now the final lead out by Fanini, and Cipollini checks over to see who's on his wheel. He'll see Blijlevens there. Also Missalia and Caranta is there, who won yesterday. But this time Cipollini gets his first stage win of this year's Giro, and he's 26th in all. And when he does win, Paul, he makes it look so easy.
But he's got such a great team there. The last man on the front there is Gian Matteo Fanini. Once Cipollini kicks in, though, it is unbelievable. He's got such a turn of speed. But look at that. Miron Blylevens is coming up pretty rapidly. And the salute there, just in fact, giving him a possibility to go across the line half a length in front. But the time bonus makes him the new pink jersey on the line.
So Mario Cipollini is the leader of the Giro d'Italia and now ready to defend what is a very small lead of just a few seconds, but at least he's done what he intended to do. Now to the third stage, Catania to Messina, and this is 176 kilometres, just the one climb in the middle, a little bit of a brute, it's over 1,000 metres, but the race seemingly has got through that okay. Now Lamprey team Paul, seemingly in control of the race now, as they bring it all back together with 45 kilometres to go.
All the teams of the sprinters, Phil, taking advantage of the first few days of the Giro to keep the group together to make sure that they've got a chance of getting a stage victory. Lamprey are working for their man, Jans Ferreira, who's a very good sprinter, which is why we've got so many of these teams at the front, keeping a compact group.
The one man, of course, we haven't spoken about yet, and we didn't expect to, Marco Pantani, keeping out of these tough days for the sprinters as they try to make their way around this island of Sicily.
There's been a crash, Phil. There's half a dozen riders have gone down at the front of the pack, and they've actually blocked the road.
Well, it's amazing. They're all stopped still on the road down there, and everybody is down at the moment, and the bunch has come to a complete halt. Not the whole field has stopped, of course. Putting his bottle back on the machine, there's Dirk Muhl of Germany. There's the pink jersey. Cipollini has fallen here, and looks a little bit stunned at the moment.
Well, that was incredible because the crash happened right near the front of the main field in about 20th position. All of these guys are down. Cipollini looks okay, but look at all the red jerseys. The whole team have waited for him. This man is the leader of the Giro at the moment. But in fact, information coming to us is, in fact, he's up and riding again. But that was a big knock.
Well, the wind was being blamed for that crash there because the wind has been very strong today here on the island. And in fact, most of the riders are getting back into the group and they're all coming together. 7 kilometres from the finish here now as Mercatoni Uno set the pace at the front. TVM in the grey jerseys, the new colours this year, by the way, are trying to move up their man at Jerome Blylevens.
You can see 1, 2, 3 grey jerseys. Then you can see a red, blue and white jersey. That's the champion of Russia, Sergei Ivanov. And in the Chiklamina or the mauve jersey, that is Jerome Blylevens. He's actually wearing the points jersey at the moment. And he now is trying to get himself a few more bonus points because with that crash for Mario Cipollini, he may well be able to outfox him today when it comes down to the sprint.
Perhaps I should remind you that the green jersey in the Giro d'Italia is not for the points award like the Tour de France. It is, in fact, for the King of the Mountains, just to confuse us all. So watch out for that as we go along. But there's counterattacks coming here now. Looks like Vini Calderola rider trying to slip away from the field. But the whole field are reorganising. Now, the pink jersey is down there. You can see him. Mario Cipollini, the winner yesterday. He's got a 4-second lead overall over Blylevens, 8 seconds over Ivan Caranta. And they're both sprinters, remember, and they're both in the hunt again today.
Cipollini's a long way down, Phil. He's around about 25th position at the moment. We're not too far from the line. He needs to move up quite quickly because otherwise he won't find the gap opening. On the front, a lot of teams starting to organise the chase. In fact, right on the front now is the Navigari team. They want their man Balducci to get up in the sprint, but also the team of the man who won the first day, Ivan Quaranta, is also very much to the fore.
Well, everybody holding off until they can, but Cipollini really could do with moving up. He's got his red guard around him. They're running down to the finish. They haven't taken control of this bunch sprint like they would normally do. I don't know if Cipollini has hinted to them. He's feeling a bit rough after that crash. It looked a bit of an ugly fall for him, but he hasn't taken the chance to get through, and this is a perfect road to move up.
It looks as if his team have got through. The red and white jerseys are starting to appear at the front. There he is. Cipollini, in fact, has moved up to 10th place, but there's a counter-attack going down the right-hand side, which didn't go very far off the front at all. Cipollini now has moved up. Today, Phil, he's decided to follow Jerome Blylevens. Yesterday, it was the other way round, and this is not the best way for Cipollini to sprint. He always needs to sprint from the front, and then once he gets a clear shot at the line, he tempts everybody else to try and come past him.
Well, he's chosen the wheeler of Jerome Blylevens, Cipollini, and just behind Cipollini there, we can see the rider Miguel Martin, but he's not going to be in at the sprint, although he's got a good sprinter's wheel right now. The pace being set by the Russian champion Ivanov and two Seiko boys and a third one going up to send dispatches. Now they're trying to organise. So look at the pink jersey, completely squashed out of it there. A lot of bumping and barging going on. He's not enjoying this run up to the finish.
Well, he's taken a big risk today. He's decided, in fact, to let his team ride on the front. 1, 2, 3 of them there, right on the first three positions, setting a very good pace. pace, 1 kilometre to go now, but Cipollini is getting boxed in and surrounded by other riders because he's fighting for the wheel of Jerome Blijlevens.
He's fighting for it, and he has lost it at the moment. In fact, Jan Zverader has found it, and he's going to hold on to it again. He's barging with the rider and been bumped off it, in fact, and so he's gone back alongside Cipollini as we look on head-on now as the Seiko boys are leading out and realised that Big Mario is not behind them and sat up. Mario is still behind, deep in the field here, and he's going to have to find a way through because there's an awful lot of bumping and barging going on at the moment. Andrea Leone and Nicola Manali are right there on the nose now. Cipollini is not going to get through this lot. There's far too many of them. Watch out, though, on the far left of the picture there as Jan Zarada and Stratza comes now. Mariano Stratza and right to the middle of them now, bursting through Zarada, and on the line is Blijlevens in that mauve jersey. So Jerome Blijlevens gets his sixth win of the year, and he came from nowhere, and Cipollini was on his wheel with a kilometre to go.
Well, Cipollini obviously got the wrong tactics today. He should have had confidence in his team. They know how to launch him into orbit, but he fought for the wheel of this man, Jerome Blijlevens. He picked a good wheel, but he just could not stay on it.
So the reward, too, is this magnificent trophy. They like the big trophies here. And also the Maglia Rosa as leader of the tour. So Blijlevens getting the victory over Zarada and Stratza and Manali. That was the order over the line. So what a great tour for the Dutchman, now facing up to a fairly long stage here of 186 kilometres. 157 riders are still in the event. Remember, we lost two with that anti-blood doping control right at the start of the event. And the riders in no hurry here. It's an uphill finish today, and Blijlevens will be lucky to hold on to that leader's pink jersey. One day away from the mountains, too.
Blijlevens got all his team at the front, but in fact they couldn't do anything to stop this breakaway. Mauro Radelli, he's a rider who's been pro since 1994 and he's never yet had a stage victory to his credit. At the moment, his advantage 2 minutes 33 seconds over the main field.
Slowly but surely they're beginning to reel him in, though. He's been out further than that and he's been away for a long time now as the field behind here, just keeping steady tempo. There's not been any big effort there. The green jersey of the King of the Mountains being led at the moment by Paolo Bettini. But the big action will start in that tomorrow. This is the intergiro sprint here, and he's still clear. Gets himself a few points in that at the 25 kilometres to go banner.
Radelli went out early on to try and build up a big lead, but it's really going to be difficult for him to hold on because this finishing climb up to Terme Lugiani is very difficult indeed. It's only around about 2.5 kilometres of climbing, and that's certainly where he's going to lose the majority of his advantage if he still stays clear. But he seems pretty happy with the publicity he's getting just at the moment. A quick tap with the team manager there as he looks over his shoulder. He can probably see the main field not too far behind.
He certainly can, just over the back of those cars. Well, we're heading down now towards Terme Lugiani. And this is the Calabrian spa town. Long straight road here. He hasn't got a chance of survival now as they'll sweep him up. And he's going to get caught with about 23 kilometres to go to the finish. And it shouldn't be a day for the sprinters either. It's not a steep climb uphill, but it is a challenge.
Should be hard enough to get rid of riders like Jerome Blijlevens and Mario Cipollini because it is a very difficult ascension up here to the finish line. It'll give chance really for some of the riders who are better at the uphill finishes to come to the front here. There's the capture there of the man who's been away for almost 111 kilometres. He's back in the main field now looking across at the speed and lots of attacks, Phil, coming almost immediately after the capture.
Well, for a while too, Paul, he enjoyed what it was like to lead the Giro d'Italia because he'd regained all his lost time, but that's all gone now as the riders once again try to get a little move going here now as they race down towards the finish. And there's some sensational descent still to come before we climb actually up to the top to the finish in Lugiani.
Michel Laffis, the Swedish rider on the TVM squad at the front there. But I have to say one thing, Phil, about Italy. There are some pretty precarious descents. This is not a major climb the riders have just been over, but it's kind of a shortcut off the main road. And you can see just how difficult and technical the descents here are in the Tour of Italy. And it really has strung out the main field. The best place to be there, in fact, is in the front 10 or 15 places.
Easier said than done because of the pressure now being applied at the front. There's four riders, in fact, have gone down the road. And here they are. The one here is Alessandro Petacci from the Navigare team. There's the full lineup. Bettini's got himself in there too, the King of the Mountains leader. And Petito, also another good climber, and also Gabriella Massaglia. And Massaglia, also a real candidate, a very good stage race rider.
Alessandro Petaccio, winner of a stage of the Tour de Lancawi, a very good rider to get away in small groups like this and look towards a stage victory. Not a great sprinter from the big bunches, but I can tell you one thing, Phil, there's big organisation in that group, and it's coming from TVM, who want to keep their man, in Jeroen Blijlevens, in the lead for as long as possible, which is why they're staying to the front. They're not getting much help today either from Mario Cipollini's team. I would think Mario is still smarting a bit from that crash yesterday.
I see Laurent Jalabert, who only came into the race with a couple of days before the start. Everybody was surprised he did enter the Giro d'Italia. He's never ridden this race before, and there he is down there now, and this is a typical approach for him. It's not a pure sprinter's race, and a number of riders who have got long-term ambitions in the Tour have been seen near the front today, probably because they could lose time on the climb to the finish.
This is the kind of stage finish today where there could be a split in the main field, and you could crazily lose 15 or 20 seconds if you're not careful and paying attention. That group at the front there has been pulled back in, but Bettini's pretty keen to get away again. But now it is, in fact, the red guard of Mario Cipollini coming to the front to sort it all out. The Lamprey rider there on the front 66, that's Missaglia. Gabriel Missaglia switched across this winter from the Mappe squad to ride on the Mappe squad when half the team split, some of them remaining with the Belgian-Italian version, which stayed Mappe, and then the others deciding to switch across to the Lamprey squad. The white jersey of the world champion there is another Lamprey rider, that's Oscar Kamenzind.
And there's Mario Cipollini. He's got the mauve jersey on today, switched partnerships with Jeroen Blijlevens. He gave Blijlevens his pink leader's jersey. As they now, he's still fancying his chances quite clearly, Big Mario, because he's got his boys up front setting the pace as they run down towards the end of this stage, again in hot conditions. We're on the mainland now, don't forget, having crossed overnight from the island.
You can just see the ball head on the yellow jersey there of the man wearing number one, Marco Pantani. He too, Phil, is being very attentive on this finish. All of these riders know that there could be a gap in the bunch, and you don't want to lose time like that.
Well, it's the first time we've actually noted Pantani in the field, and he's come up towards the front as we approach the climb now, 1 kilometre to the finish, but as I say, it's uphill. A lot of riders pushing their way through because the final push-up for the line hasn't started yet. Seiko are still setting the pace as well, and looking down there, not in evidence, the Maglia Rosa worn today by Jeroen Blijlevens.
This is certainly not the kind of finish for Jeroen Blijlevens. There, 61 is the world champion Kamenzind. In fact, the Cantina Tolo riders are moving up to the front now as well. That is Marco Magnani, and following him, Daniele De Luca. But they won't be looking after their sprinter today. Nicola Minali is a lot further down the main field.
And still no sign of that pink jersey, but they're crashing the foot. But Jalabert is off to the left. He's got a good wheel to follow there in the rainbow jersey of Oscar Kamenzind. Kamenzind starting his season this year in Australia in the Tour Down Under. Now, we're running in towards the line and everybody is leaving their sprint late. In fact, I am surprised we are seeing so many riders here in with a chance of victory. The bunch itself, well, probably 50 riders have survived together here now as they start to make their run towards the line. And Kamenzind fancies his chances now, the world champion and a Swiss rider as well. And Laurent Jalabert, who rides, the French champion, rides on the Spanish Once team. As they now make a go for the line. Now, this is a perfect finish now because Jalabert is winding it up from the front at 75 metres to go. And that is not Cipollini who's having a dig, but it is Fagnini who's trying to come for him. Normally the lead-out man for Cipollini. But Jalabert is going to get his first ever stage win in the Giro d'Italia. And he can marry those up now with his Tour de France stage wins and his Tour of Spain stage wins. That's a complete hand for you. Well done.
That's his 10th win of the season. A great win by Laurent Jalabert. Perfectly timed. This is certainly the kind of finish definitely made for this man. He's a great uphill sprinter. He was a good sprinter on the flats at one stage, but nowadays he has to wait for it to be a slightly slower sprint where he can use his power. And today he used it to good credit, and he's closed in on the pink jersey.
Well, there's the result. David Rebellin getting third and Kamenzind slipping away to finishing in fourth place there. But overall, he's kept his lead, but only by 18 seconds over Laurent Jalabert. And I doubt very much whether that will matter now, Paul, because this first day in the mountains, really, with the mountaintop finish, and we get down to the finish on Monte Sereno. 147 kilometres the stage today from Terme Luigiani, and a chance, I think, to see the big boys coming out to play.
Certainly it won't be a sprinter wearing the pink jersey of the leader of the Giro d'Italia this evening, because this is a very difficult climb. 22 kilometres of climb, and the average is only 4%, so it's not that hard, but there are certain points on the climb, Phil, where it steepens up to 9%.
Well, this climb simply goes on, and these are the first boys to attack on it. They've just pulled away a little bit. Chepe González is here, and also here, Danilo De Luca. Also, nice to see Pascal Richard, the Olympic champion. We might get a shot of him shortly. You'll see the Olympic rings on his jersey because he's had a bit of a rough time since he won that title, and he's coming back this year.
Richard Virenque riding for Polti this year, looking to try and ride well in the mountains at the Giro d'Italia, but I think he will have to work a little harder for Ivan Gotti, because Ivan Gotti here in Italy certainly must be regarded as the leader of the Polti squad. The Vitalicio Seguros rider on the back there was Hernan Buenahora, a very good Colombian climber, and it was interesting to see Danilo De Luca for the Cantina Tolo riders in there, Phil, because he was actually mixing it at the front in the sprint yesterday.
Well, it seems to me there are a number of riders from Italy now who can both climb and sprint, but the pressure's still on the front. They're not really slipping away from the main field, which is getting smaller and smaller. This is a 22-kilometre climb, which is about 13 miles, with an average gradient of 4%, but it does have stretches of 9%, so it's quite a tough one. And just holding the limit of the main group here and leading up front is Alex Zula. And this must be a tough time for him. He's literally returned from suspension for the misuse of the blood booster EPO to ride in the Tour of Italy. So it's going to be hard for Alex today.
What the team has done with Alex Zula since the start of the season, in fact, has taken him to nearly all of the races the team has been participating in, and he's actually been riding the race route at almost race speed to try and give himself at least the distance and the speed of competition. But this is the first real test for Alex Zula, but he's thinking a lot further down the road. I reckon he's using the Giro d'Italia here as preparation for the Tour de France.
Well, we'll find out as this race goes on over 3 weeks. De Luca up there, we just caught a glimpse of Jose Maria Jimenez are just behind Alex Zula. That's a more likely candidate for final victory, I think. Well, here's Pascal Richard. Been racing an awful long time, and he has a habit, Paul, as he always has through his career, to slip into the right moves.
They call him the cat because he's a very clever rider. He knows just exactly when to pounce, and when he does pounce, it's always for a big victory somewhere along the line. He always manages to get a big victory somewhere throughout a season, although the last couple of years he really has been dogged by a lot of illness ever since he, in fact, won the Olympic Championships in Atlanta 1996. In fact, he had an operation on his back. That's Andrea Pirron, the rider from Onze. They're trying to get himself back up to the leaders here, and this man, Chepe González, is a fantastic little climber, and he certainly bounces up to win big stages here and there. He's already won a stage of the Giro d'Italia and a stage of the Tour de France as well.
And let's not forget, he was King of the Mountains in this event a couple of years ago. He really is. The Kelme team have always taken a big slice of the glory from the Giro d'Italia over the years, and it looks like this year is going to be no exception. There's the three men. They're not clear of the field. Here is the field again with Jimenez and Zula on the front, but the rest are lining up behind him. Mariano Piccoli just passing through. Oscar Camerzind is also there.
Looking down through the field, I can't see the pink jersey of Jeroen Blijlevens, though. He's a lot further down the mountain. He was the man who started off this morning as the pink jersey leader of the Giro d'Italia, but all of the sprinters, Mario Cipollini included, have been blown away today on the slopes of this climb here up to Monte Sereno. This is Andrea Pirron having a fantastic season, looking over his shoulder. In fact, Pirron has been very close to winning a couple of mountaintop finishes in the recent past. In fact, he was very close to winning one in the Tour of Spain a couple of years ago, so he too riding exceptionally well now with his switch as well across to the Onze squad during the winter months.
He's De Luca doing a lot of work here, looking right down the bends there. A couple of motorbikes coming round, and De Luca's done the same to see if he can see anybody coming across, but at the moment the gap is still there. In fact, he's taking a good look to see who has reacted from the field, and I must say they must have now around about 30 seconds.
Ernesto doing a lot of work there. You can see the red, white and blue jersey of Laurent Jalabert with the sunglasses on. He's riding comfortably at the front. Marco Pantani is safely in this group as well. But these three leaders, Phil, they're still holding on with 5 kilometres to go to an advantage of 30 seconds. But watch out for Chepe González there, number 54 at the back. He's a very clever rider. He always manages to feign a bit of fatigue. I remember him outfoxing Piotr Ugrimov to win his stage of the Tour de France. He sat on That's the Russian right. for ages and ages. And then when he got sight of the line, boom, and he couldn't do anything about it.
Can't blame him for that, but this road towards the top gets very narrow. If you've got the strength, it's ideal to attack on, because as you can see, it's wooded and it twists in and out before we get up towards the line. De Luca is doing a lot of work here on the front, and here's the man that seems to make his occupation of travelling around all the big races and standing near the finish. To put the curse on some and to cheer home others. The devil. 5 kilometres to go now for the pack. Now gone from this field is the pink jersey of Jerome Blyleven's Paul. That would now mean that Jalabert is the obvious next candidate, and what a return that would be for him in this race. Not a return, but the first time he'd have pulled the Magli Rosa on.
That would be a great performance by Jalabert. There's the attack. Gonzalez has gone. He waited for the moment, and it's De Luca who's going to respond there. De Luca straight onto his wheel, trying to close down. This is exactly what you have to do.
Well, Danilo De Luca too, if he can just get the gap over the field, would be the next leader, and that's probably why he is doing all of the work here. The stage been not so important to him, but if he could just win with the right time gap, he would be in the pink jersey of race leader, and that's a big thing for the Italian, and that's why they've pounced on the attack there by Kepi. And 4 kilometres still to climb to the summit, and Peron also back in the thick of it. But again, De Luca is lifting the pace.
Andrea Peron, you notice, is not working too hard either, because he's in a position to try and defend, in fact, the position of Laurent Jalabert, because in the right combination, Jalabert could be the new leader of the Giro this evening. This climb field doesn't seem to be quite steep enough, though, for Chepe González. He's, in fact, moving up to the third spot there, and again, he's going to try it.
Here it comes again. And this time, oh, they're a little bit slow on the reaction because he gave them plenty of warning there, but he sprinted away again. And this is how they do it back home. You sprint and then you ease, and if they come up to you, you attack again. That's the climber's style. But I have to hand it to Danilo De Luca. He is a tenacious man today. He's got himself, and he's going to have a dig himself and see if Kepi has not recovered from this. And in fact, Gonzalez looks over to see if Peron is going to answer, and I don't think Andrea has it.
Andrea Peron is not a great climber. He wasn't able to respond to that attack, and all those attacks there by Chepe González have left him a little short of wind there. And in fact, it's De Luca who's taken the advantage, and he hit them just at the right time, coming straight after two attacks by Chepe González. He launched an attack, but González now trying to respond. But this kind of climb is not suited to the little Colombian.
Well, Danilo De Luca has really done well here now to get away from this lot. But look at the way he is climbing back into it here now, because he is looking as though Chepe González is going to catch up again here. And in fact, González is on him, and we're not too far from the finish.
Well, that was a pretty good recovery by Chepe González. He is a great climber, but he prefers the longer, big, steeper climbs of the Alps and the Pyrenees. Here, he's managed to recover and pull himself back to the wheel of De Luca. De Luca is riding exceptionally. We've got a bit of a problem here, Phil. The pictures have gone to black and white. That must be something to do with the uplink from the helicopter down here to the finish line.
Well, we'll have to bear with them. There isn't much we can do about them as we look down on the peloton here. Now, De Luca, by the way, is a new pro. He joined Cantina Tolo this year, and he's now trying to win the stage. I'm sorry about these pictures. It looks as though we've got a camera going down at the moment, but we're still with the leaders here, and they're still trying to get this man away to victory. Danilo De Luca, first-year pro.
Bit of chaos as well there. They're getting all of the motorbikes out of the way. That's because right behind the main field is closing down pretty quickly as well. But it's still De Luca on the front, and Chepe González, the Colombian climber who's tried several times to go clear, but these two riders riding well together. But De Luca, in fact, is riding to try and get himself the pink jersey of the Giro d'Italia, which is why he's getting no help at all from Chepe González. These bike riders, despite the fact they're riding up a 22-kilometre mountain, have already worked out the permutations. That's why González is sitting in second spot.
Well, De Luca was the man who started the move right at the bottom of the climb. The peloton have always been in touch but haven't quite closed the gap yet, but it looks as though they're coming now, because there they are off to the right, and they are desperately close to the finish, these two, and I'm not so sure they're going to hang on as they close in. De Luca is just draining himself on this climb. He's desperate to hang on. I think his chances may be going for the pink jersey, but and look at this, Gonzalez has gone.
He waited till the very last moment there. He waited to let De Luca set all the pace at the front and jump straight past him. But De Luca hasn't given up, Phil. He's responded as well in the steepness of that corner to try and come back to the Colombian's wheel.
Absolutely brilliant riding by Danilo De Luca, a first-year pro, and he is now just being beaten for a stage in the Giro d'Italia by Chepe González, who's done it before. It was the 20th stage he won a couple of years ago. He's gone a lot earlier this time out. The former King of the Mountains now gets a clear shot at home. Now, let's hope De Luca can hang on. It's not going to be by very much, is it? Because as González crosses the line, De Luca just about gets it, and that is Laurent Jalabert, who gets third place right on the wheel of De Luca, and that must give him the pink jersey of the Giro d'Italia.
But in fact, Phil, just coming across there alongside Laurent Jalabert was Marco Pantani. He's got a scarf over his head. It was difficult to see him with these picture problems we've got at the moment. But in fact, Pantani came up in fourth. So he too will be climbing pretty much up the overall standings. But this damage has been done by this final climb of the day up to Monte Serrano.
Well, there's the man who's the star of the day, but Pantani obviously a little bit worried about the whereabouts of Laurent Jalabert, because this is a tour which Jalabert expects to feature highly in now, having won a stage and got the leader's pink jersey as well. But the winner today, Chepe González, ahead of Daniel De Luca, Laurent Jalabert, and there's confirmation, Pantani and Ivan Gotti in fifth place as well. So the heads did come out, finishing just 6 seconds back. The pink jersey then on the shoulders now of Laurent Jalabert by 7 seconds. That's all over De Luca. He almost made it. Rebolant is third. And today should be a day of consolidation for Laurent Jalabert, the longest stage of the tour, a massive 257 kilometres from Loria to Foggia. And this, the sixth day of racing, and the field more or less has stayed together, Paul, as I think we expected.
Well, this is a very long stage and a lot of wind coming along the course as well, which has really kept it together. You can see now, as we come closer to the finish, that it is again a day for the sprinters. Mario Cipollini's pretty close there on the wheel again of Jeroen Blijlevens, but it's always at the end of these stages, Phil, up to the red guard of Seiko Cannondale to come to the front and set the pacemaking.
The only break of the day worth talking about, really, was the one between the Italian Andrea Taffi and the Colombian Victor Peña from Vitalicio. They were away for something like 115 kilometres, but we're all together now. Now, can Mario Cipollini come back on the scene here? He's been a bit quiet yesterday, but that was to be expected, as again the Seiko boys now try to get on terms, and that looks like it's Roberto Petito, but he hasn't got many friends around him right now.
Trying to keep the pace high for Mario Cipollini. Cipollini was hovering around there in 7th or 8th place, but also Laurent Jalabert in the pink jersey riding very much to the front on this stage. There you can see in 3rd position is the world champion Oscar Kamenzind. He's trying to ride to the front for his teammate Jans Verrada. Verrada, an excellent sprinter. In 2nd place there is Gabriele Missaglia. Coming into a precarious corner now. Now's the time not to touch the brakes, because if you do, you lose 10 or 15 places in a sprint like this.
Well, Oscar Kammer's in there, took your tip, Paul. He didn't touch his brakes and he's still holding on to third place. I have to say, the world champion is very prominent in this opening week of the tour. On the sort of stages I didn't think entirely suited him, but he's very vigilant and pushing his form forward as he hopes. Now an attack there, and it's gone by Gabriele Massaglia, and it is gone, and look at the way it's open here. Remember that we're in the last kilometre, and now there's going to have to be a very fast reaction here. Otherwise, this man has won the stage. Lamprey have been looking for the victory with Jans Verrada. Now they may get it from a rather stranger quarter of Gabriele Massaglia as he raced down the barriers, but the riders are coming on the right here at a terrific rate of knot, and that is Guidi and Veenstein's coming neck and neck, and I think they're going to catch Massaglia right on the line here. Or are they? Yes, and Roman Veenstein's takes it on the line. Fabrizio Guidi very close there alongside Gabriele Massaglia.
Well, Massaglia moved at the right time there. It was in fact helped by Kamenzind, but they could do nothing against this man, Roman Veenstein's, who certainly this year is the revelation of the season.
And for him, it was his 7th win, but in fact, Jalabert keeping the same time gains of 7 seconds over the rest of the field. And so to the end of the opening week of the Giro d'Italia with the 7th stage from Foggia to Lanciano, 153 kilometres. And the riders still 157 strong, but they're objecting this morning against the blood testing controls being done by the Italian Olympic Committee. And the reason is that they're quite happy with the blood test being made by the World Body and the Italian Cycling Federation, but they're objecting against the controls by the Italian Olympic Committee. At one stage, they weren't going to take part at all, but Pantani has led a group of people, a good group of cyclists, saying that they will ride for the sake of the fans who watch them, and they're very happy to take all of the controls but not those of the Italian Olympic Committee. And as expected, Paul, the race itself, go the day before the next longest stage of 253 kilometres, has been comparatively quiet, and the weather itself has turned against us.
Well, the weather has changed. It's amazing. After just a few days ago in Sicily, the weather was 35 degrees. Now we're moving north and we really are getting towards the bad weather. The rain has come down and that will make it pretty tricky on the run into the finish line. But two guys have got clear of the main field. That is Carlo Bianchi. Now, that's a great name to have if you're a bike rider. And Rodolfo Ongarto for the Liquigas team. But they've never really got much advantage over the main field. And a lot of work has been done at the front of the group, again by Mario Cipollini's team. But on the slopes here, in fact, it's their team of Laurent Jalabert Jalabert, the new leader of the Giro, who's at the front making the very hard tempo.
That's right. That was Bianchi just slipping back there. He's dropped back into the group now. This is Ongarato, so they're all together again. Their biggest lead they got today was 4 minutes and 10 seconds, and they got away around the kilometre 70 point. But now the Once boys taking control of the race here in defence, of course, of their race leader, Laurent Jalabert. He's Ongarato, last survivor of the long breakaway. And if he looks over his shoulder, he'll see the main field in the Giro d'Italia coming right up behind him. So there's still time now for the sprinters to sort themselves out.
Could be another chance for Mario Cipollini to get up there again. Another couple of riders trying to leap off the front. That leader there, in fact, is one of the riders from the Mapei squad who's opened up a gap of around about 200 metres. And all these guys at the moment trying to get themselves off the front of the main field as they come into the outskirts of town here. And I have to tell you, Phil, these little cobblestones they have here in the streets of many of the Italian towns with a little coating of water on them are very slippy.
Well, you can see by the way the peloton are guiding themselves around that corner. They're in no hurry here at 10 kilometres to go, which is unusual. They've strung it out a little bit now, but when the rain falls on those cobblestones, they are highly dangerous. Anyway, the riders all lying astern at the moment, as now the sprinters are trying to get back in control. Remember that Jalabert is still the race leader as they make down. Somebody's gone down on that corner. Well, I'd expect him to fall on the bend, not before it, and I can't see who it is, but he's touched the wheel and gone out of the peloton today very quickly.
You have to be so careful over the last kilometre, Phil, because if you do get caught up like that, you can take down an awful lot of riders. In third place there, your own Blylevens, followed by Fabrizio Guidi, but on the front it's the Vinnie Candirola team, Massimo Apollonio. He's leading them out.
Well, they're trying to get their man Roman Weinsteins back up in the frame, I think, because he's riding very, very well now. They've certainly put all the men up at the front. Blylevens would be very happy to sit there in third place. And Weinsteins is the rider in second right now on the wheel of Apollonio. So he's getting the perfect run down to the line.
Absolutely perfect. On his wheel, though, is in fact your own Blylevens in the Ciclamina jersey. Gabriel Misaglia is pretty close to the front. And Mario Cipollini's nowhere to be seen.
I think Weinstein's cooked his goose here because he's been forced to lead out a lot earlier than he would have liked. He's the rider on the front right now, and he's actually got Blylevens tucked in his slipstream. And here comes your own Blylevens now. He's having a great Giro. Remember, he's had one win and he's had the pink jersey now. Can he get this? Yes, he can, very, very easily. Well, Weinstein's did well there to hang on to second place. I think it was Fabrizio Guidi who got third. And there's the confirmation, it was indeed Bettini fourth, Piccoli taking fifth place, and a pretty nice result there for Blylevens, but Laurent Jalabert keeps the pink. But now it's going to be a big test for him, especially on the eve of the first time trial of 32 kilometres as well, because this is a massive stage, Paul. Look at this, 253 kilometres, finishes right on top of the Alto del Gran Sasso.
2,130 metres. And again, Phil, the weather not clement. Really cold start this morning. Everybody in racing capes. And these guys, they don't like to race in situations like this, especially when you've got to go into the big mountain passes.
Well, there's nothing more depressing than riding away on this long stage when the rain is coming down like this and waiting to welcome you at the top of the climbs is fog, snow and pretty low temperatures. But the Tour of Italy over the years, it's well chronicled. You get bad days. If you remember the year that Andy Hampson rode so well, he was up amongst the snowstorms as well. And this is looking like the first decent breakaway of the day here. Two riders getting clear. Mariano Piccoli is the man following Pietro Coccioli.
And this is on a very long stage too, 253 kilometres, the second longest stage of the Giro d'Italia. And to have a big mountain like that right at the end certainly is a major sting in the tail. Laurent Jalabert is going to be put under serious pressure today to see how he performs in the big mountains, because Jalabert, Phil, he's always felt that he can be a big stage race rider, but when it does come to the big mountain passes, he always seems to crack. And I reckon one man who's going to go out today and put pressure on him is Marco Pantani, who we've hardly really seen near the front of the race so far.
The only time he appeared was when we had that short finishing uphill climb, and then he was there. Now, Mariano Piccoli is an extremely good climber as well as a good sprinter, and it looks as though Pantani, though, has sent his boys up today, because that was Simone Borghese setting the pace and taking over for him now, Riccardo Forconi.
173 is Bernan Buenahora. Now, really trying to get off the front again, it's the Kelme squad. It's always these guys when we come to the tough mountain stages. Chepe González, already a stage winner, looking for another win. But the two leaders still got a serious advantage fairly well up the road, Mariano Piccoli and Pietro Coccioli. I have to say one thing, Mariano Piccoli is an incredibly versatile rider, Phil, because he's one of the rare guys who, not only has he won the King of the Mountains in the Giro d'Italia, but he's also won the points competition.
That's right, and the riders, by the way, have had a big fallout with the Mappe team this morning because the Mappe team decided to work with the Italian Olympic Committee on the blood testing, and they've fallen out with some of the riders. In fact, Andrea Taffy this morning was in tears because of all the insults being thrown at him by other riders in the race, and we haven't seen much of the Mappe riders at the front today.
It's always a very strange thing. The big problem about the sport of cycling is the riders really need to have a strong union, but there's always one team or another who will go against the group. And if you don't work together as a unit, you're never going to come up with any kind of decisions. But the majority of the riders, really, I have to agree with them, because you can't go through a race like the Tour of Italy and have four or five different governing bodies coming in and testing these riders on a regular basis. It has to be done by the International Cycling Union, and they have to do it in agreement with the Olympic Committee.
Well, we're back up with the leaders now, but we caught a glimpse there of Borghese setting the pace, and it does appear to me that Pantani has told his team to ride like he is the leader of the Tour today, and that is set the pace, because the Onsay team of Laurent Jalabert haven't been seen at the front, and that's an interesting tactic switchabout. These are the two leaders as they continue on the long, steady climb up towards the fog and the snow of the Gran Sasso.
You can see now there's the front of the main field, though. It's not a very big main field either at the moment. A lot of riders are going to lose big time today on a stage like this. Just caught a glimpse there of Richard Viron comfortably in the group over to the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side of the group, the leader of the Polti squad, Ivan Gotti, was also looking pretty comfortable indeed. There in second position in the green and white is Chepe González. And all the big names, Phil, are actually in this group. Sergei Ivanov there is the champion of Russia. He's riding very much to the fore. He's a rider who in a couple of years' time, I think, will be a very good stage race rider. For the moment, he seems pretty happy just to work for Jeroen Blijlevens in the sprints.
Well, these two have been away for just over 200 kilometres now, and I think they're about to surrender to the field behind when you see them take a drink like that. The steady tempo, there's Laurent Jalabert. We've got a couple of Onsay riders near him, and not too far away now from the head of the field, but look at that small select group which is climbing away, and Jalabert is part of that selection.
Mariano Piccoli now realises that it's almost over for these guys. They've been at the front for an awful long time, and in weather conditions like this, they certainly now must be starting to get pretty tired, because behind, it's been all pressure on this climb all of the time. There's been somebody coming to the front trying to keep the pace high. In the black jersey there, the Navigari rider, in fact, is Niklas Axelsson, who finished third overall in the Tour de Langkawi last year. A very good young man when it comes to these big mountain stages, and another rider we'll see a lot of towards the future.
Having a little glimpse at the back of what is a very contented pack here with Andre Teteriuk from Liquigas sitting on the tail there. But the pace being made all the time by Borghese and also Chepe González. And Bueno Hora is the Vitalicio rider also up here. But still at the front now, and Pantani himself has taken control now, and that's forcing Ivan Gotti to follow his wheel. And also Oscar Kammerzind, he's in third place. So this is a very serious move now. When Pantani moves, you've got to take note.
Jimenez is the rider pretty close to the front there for the Banesto squad, but looking down that line quite briefly there, I couldn't see the pink jersey of Laurent Jalabert, so he's obviously having difficulty following the rhythm here being set by Marco Pantani, but that's not the case for Ivan Gotti, because he's right on the wheel of the Pirate, and this is the first time we've really seen the Pirate in action this year during the Giro d'Italia. But he has had a very good season, Phil. He started off riding well early on, unlike many of the other Tour de France contenders who take a back seat and don't even show until they come through to July. This man was already in form very much back in February.
Well, Pantani is out of the saddle. This is an unusual style for Marco, because he normally accelerates from the group and tries to see who can follow, settles in, then accelerates again. This time, he's just sitting at the front, riding at this tempo, and he's ridden everybody off his wheel except Gotti.
The last man to hold on there, you could just get a glimpse of him in the clouds there, in fact, was Jose Maria Jimenez, the former champion of Spain, the man who many feel has got a great chance of riding high in the overall rankings in this race here. But Pantani started his season off, Phil, with an overall win in the Tour of Murcia back in March, which is absolutely phenomenal performance when you think this man is looking again to try and win the Giro d'Italia and go forward to ride the Tour de France. But these conditions up here really are abysmal, and I tell you one thing, it is very cold at the top of this finish line, and the the rider's really not too happy with the conditions. And I tell you one thing, Pantani is not happy with Gotti.
Well, I don't think Gotti can do a thing about it. We saw his face there. He can't possibly go through on this ride and help him. I think he's trying to tell him that. He's just trying to control there, Marco Pantani, this little man who makes climbing mountains look so easy. Pantani thinks, well, if you can sit behind me, you can come and help me out. But really, I don't think he can.
The problem here is this climb is not quite steep enough for Marco Pantani to ride Ivan Gotti off his wheel, and Gotti now coming forward. This is a psychological moment now, because he's actually showing Pantani that he is his equal at the moment, or he's hoping that will be the case, and he's hoping that that will dissuade the little pirate from attacking further up the mountain. These two riders now are building up a pretty nice advantage over the rest of the riders in the field, and one man in serious difficulty, 40 seconds behind the pirate at the moment on the road, is Laurent Jalabert.
Well, the way Pantani's going here, on the eve of the time trial, don't forget, where Jalabert could be expected to come back into his own tomorrow, he could do with holding on to this man and keeping him in his sights just by enough seconds to keep the pink jersey, because then he would get the last start position in the time trial. And Gotti is just closing his eyes and suffering and hoping he can hang on to this man right now. And Pantani has good form, because earlier in March he won the Tour of Murcia. He's also had a stage win in the Catalan week, so he wanted to win this tour. He's made no secret about it. He's always said this is his tour, the route is for him. And now on the first big climb, the first serious climb of this year's Giro, he has decided to give them a demonstration.
And he's just cracked Gotti. Gotti couldn't keep the pace. Pantani not super confident. He keeps looking around to see what sort of damage he's been doing. And for a long time there, I could still see Jose Maria Jimenez, the Banesto rider, just hanging on there, keeping himself in contact. But now he's broken the elastic. Now he's done what he wanted to do. That's get rid of Ivan Gotti, the former winner of the Giro d'Italia. He now rides for the Polti squad. He won the Giro d'Italia for Seiko Cannondale. And now he's the leader of the Polti riders here at the Giro d'Italia. But Marco Pantani now has managed to break clear, and he's the first man out on the road.
Well, you notice his style, Paul. He rides on the bottom of the handlebars. He sits in that saddle for about half a second and then he kicks out again, almost as if he's sprinting up this climb. He's not climbing like we expect a real climber to climb right now. This is a flat-out effort in any way he can get to the summit.
He's trying to keep his pace as high as possible. He sits down occasionally to give himself a bit of a rest just to recuperate, and he feels he's not going fast enough. So as soon as he gets that sensation, he gets out of the saddle to accelerate again. This is a bit of chaos. This is what happens at the Giro d'Italia. The Tifosi go absolutely mad. They're right in there trying to encourage Marco Pantani, and there's the drag. There's the flag of the skull and crossbones to celebrate the pirate on the lead.
Well, a massive crowd up here on what are really miserable conditions. You can see them lining the road as we continue to make the ascent here. And they expected to see Marco Pantani on a climb like this dictating affairs. They've not been disappointed. This man is the number one sportsman in Italy right now, and he's helping push cycling to be the number one sport as well, even ahead of football. And some 900 metres to go, and Pantani is clear.
Fantastic performance to see Marco Pantani climbing up these mountains. He certainly is the best climber in the world. Nobody can rival his accelerations, but today it wasn't his accelerations that got rid of Ivan Gotti. It was really the constant pace that he was setting. It was just that little bit too difficult for Ivan Gotti to follow. He tried to stay in contact with the pirate, but eventually he just popped off his wheel, and now that's leaving the pirate to head up to what will be a great stage victory, because nobody is going to catch him, Phil. He's not showing any signs of weakness at all. Every time he slows below what he feels is a fast rhythm, he gets out of the saddle and accelerates once again.
Well, we're not seeing anything of the chasers now. They are spread over the mountain. I don't know what's happened to our second moto camera. We're only staying with Pantani. We hear, though, that Gotti and Zulla and Jimenez are together now. So good climbing by the man who's really one of the pre-race favourites in Jose Maria Jimenez. And Alex Zulla, well, he just continues to surprise at the moment.
Surprising to see that Jose Maria Jimenez has decided to concentrate his season this year on the Giro d'Italia and the Vuelta a España. He doesn't want to go to the Tour de France, a race where I think in a couple of years' time he would have a serious chance at winning, but he wanted to come here in good form, and he's riding very well today. He has recovered from the attack of Marco Pantani. He's riding with his teammate Alex Zulla, and those guys at the moment, Phil, are just trying to limit their losses on the flying pirate.
Well, this is going to be a little bit frightening for the rest of the tour if Pantani gives a demonstration like this, because Jalabert was looking to be quite a solid leader. I would have expected he would not have expected to lose his lead today. We don't know exactly where he is on the climb, but there is a real chance now he will see his pink jersey go across to Pantani.
Well, the last time check we had on Laurent Jalabert was in fact 50 seconds, so he's not losing all that much time. He's just got to keep himself in the bike race, and in fact it could be very close between himself and Marco Pantani. But Pantani here is well within sight of the finish line, but the crowds here, Phil, despite the snow and the bad weather, are unbelievable.
Well, 22 down overnight, Pantani. So I would say he's in pink when he gets to the line. It looks as though it's become a little bit of a struggle for him these last few hundred metres. And listen to the crowd now as they shout home the man they call Il Pirata, the pirate. And Marco Pantani climbs to the summit after 7 hours in the saddle today and finishing up here. Well, the best thing he can do is get his hat and coat on and keep warm as soon as he crosses this line, because Marco Pantani is winning this stage of the Giro d'Italia, the first real challenge as far as he is concerned. And this is going to give him, for sure now, the Maglia Rosa of the Giro d'Italia. He salutes his crowd, 7 hours and 9 minutes. Now he can sit back and wait. Once 22 seconds has passed by, it's all over for the rest. And this is Jimenez now, so he must have caught Gotti. And this is Zulla. So they both pass Gotti as Jimenez comes in. And there's the time gap. Alex Zulla, his teammate, he follows over the line. So Benesto have done well today. And here is Ivan Gotti, the only man who had the courage, at least, to try and hang on to Marco Pantani.
Well, that is an incredible performance. The next man to come in is going to be Andrea Noe across the line there. Daniel Clavero, the Spanish rider from Vitalicio Seguros, but we still are going to have to wait a while for Laurent Jalabert to come in, and the clock is ticking by.
Well, he's already out of the pink jersey, and here comes Laurent Jalabert. He's just about finding the effort to get out of the saddle and keep going here in this group. He's just about going to scrape into a top 15 finish, and he's just on a minute behind. But looking here now at the bike of number one, Marco Pantani, it's been confirmed he is the new leader of the Giro d'Italia. I don't blame him for putting that overcoat on, but just look at that lovely bottle of champagne. Pantani ahead of Jimenez, Zulla and Gotti today. That was the order over the line, and the new leader now is Marco Pantani. He is in the pink jersey and everybody is happy. The face of Alex Zulla. It's a beautiful morning in Ancona for the time trial of only 32 kilometres. Another reason why Marco Pantani loves the course this year. The time trials are not that long. Alex Zulla now, Paul, and wondering if his form is still there after his suspension.
This is a big rendezvous for Alex Zulla. He was really trying to put out a great performance today. He's off the starting gate, and this is the first time he's really had to lay his time trialing reputation on the line to see if he has returned to the man that he was before.
Well, so far, he's 15th overall and a minute 44 off the lead. It's not a bad comeback just for the moment for Alex Zulla. He's still 15 kilometres to go here, 25 kilometres to go, rather. He's just come over the top of the climb. There is one sharp little climb on the course. There's the fastest time at the finishing line in Zaina, and Zinchenko is just about going to improve on that. And so that's the current situation, Paul.
Out on the course, Oscar Kammensen, in fact, not wearing his rainbow jersey in the time trial, but this man is setting some pretty fast times out on the course, Sergei Honchar. And I have to say, Phil, the opening part of this time trial is very difficult, because after 15 kilometres, these riders have a third category climb to go over, and that should suit Marco Pantani. Next man out on the course, though, is Ivan Gotti.
And this is Ivan Gotti, and sprinting away as we go further around. This is Kammensen we were talking about as he comes up towards the check here, and it looks as though he's just 2 seconds quicker than Alex Zulla over the top of the climb. So that's a good start for him, approximately halfway through. And now on to Laurent Jalabert.
Jalabert has always in the past been a very good time trialist, and this is the kind of course that would suit him, because it is a sporting course. It's a course where you have to be a strong rider for the opening climb, but also a pretty technical rider too for the descent off this climb, which it is in fact quite a risky little descent. Jalabert's coming up to the time of Sergei Goncar. And in fact, it's going to be pretty close as Jalabert goes through there for the moment, Phil, with the fastest time so far.
Well, I know he's the ex-world time trial champion, but against Sergei Goncar, that is a very good time by Jalabert. He's gone through with the best time here, only by a couple of seconds, but that's all right. He's only halfway through. Goncar, sort of a time trial specialist in the stage races, also had a silver and bronze in the World Championship as well. Now, the pink jersey, the man they said couldn't time trial, and he really socked it to them in the Giro last year, is underway. So he is chasing Laurent Jalabert and Alex Zulla, who looks as though he struggled a little bit now. He's aiming at the time of Alexander Zinchenko, 42.36. He is probably just about going to get the better of it if he can keep the rhythm going right up to the line.
Well, he doesn't look fluid like the old Alex Zullowin knew from before in the time trials, but this is going to be the fastest time as he comes up to the line. He crosses it 41.51, new best time for Alex Zuller, but there's still some pretty fast guys to come.
13 riders still out on the course behind him at the moment, as we now move out onto the course again, and looking as though we're seeing some fairly fast moving riding here by Jalabert. As he goes around the corner, he's caught his man up front, as Gonchar himself is now about to arrive, and this is going to set a new time at the top. Gonchar himself not seen as a man to challenge for the final pink jersey. Matter of pride with him, I think, as he comes round to the finish, and best time 41.01. That's going to take some beating. And look at this, at the halfway point, Jimenez is way off the pace, Paul, and again his time trial is letting him down. He's being caught, in fact, by Pantani.
Well, Jimenez is not a great time trialist. He's much more at ease in the mountains, but over the next couple of years he will improve, and I do feel that he is going to be a great three-week stage race rider. But this man, Laurent Jalabert, is having the fastest time out on the course at the moment at half distance. This is the time of Marco Pantani, but that's pretty good as well, Phil. He's gone through second best time to Laurent Jalabert, 19.49.
It's amazing he's gone faster than Gonchar, and he's snapping on the heels of Jimenez now, and the crowd are probably telling him as well, because he's gone over the top of the climb. That was his favourite bit, of course. Now it's all downhill. Looking down here from the helicopter at Laurent Jalabert, who's still setting the best time, swinging back to the finish, and Savoldelli is coming in. And as you can see, way down the length, he's sixth best. Well, he's not that far down. Not a bad ride, actually, but sixth best.
Laurent Jalabert, very strong rider. Always when I look at this man, he reminds me of the great Sean Kelly. He's doing a great ride out on the course. Niklas Axelsson is a man who could ride high in the overall rankings, and this is a pretty good time by him. Second, third best time on the line, 42 minutes, 14 seconds, but still some big names out on the course. Ivan Gotti has got to ride well if he wants to climb onto the podium at the end of this three-week tour. But look at Jalabert here, Phil, approaching 5 kilometres to go, and he's really still riding strong.
Oscar Camazin, the champion of the world, and Camazin himself choosing not to use his rainbow jersey. 41.33, second best time, and a very good ride for Oscar. He should be happy with that. This man is finding time to freewheel just now. Whether he loses his pink jersey or not, we won't know for a few kilometres yet, but he's not pushing it down here, Paul. He's just locked in and a nice steady freewheel. This rider, though, is picking up all of the riders on the road behind him, or ahead of him, really. He's putting them behind him, as Jalabert is now going to arrive with the best time. He's got the better of Sergei Gonchar. He's done him before in the World Championships as well. And Laurent Jalabert now delivering another surprise here. He never used to win time trials till he got a win in the stage of Paris-Nice time trial, and then he suddenly had arrived. 40.36 for Laurent Jalabert. You know, that might be good enough to reclaim his pink jersey. It'll all depend on what happens now, and he's passed Jimenez.
Well, that's a great ride by Marco Pantani. He's caught the man who was starting off right in front of him, Jose Maria Jimenez, the Banesto rider, for 2 minutes in this time trial. While out on the course, Dario Frigo, Phil, is putting in a pretty good time. The time to beat is that of Laurent Jalabert. He's not going to do that, but as he crosses the line, he'll go across in third place.
Well, there's Gotti as well coming in. He's also most of the riders that matter are all coming in pretty close to each other, because a time trial of only 32 kilometres is not going to make a big difference, but you've got to keep the pressure on so you don't lose too many seconds. Here comes Ivan Gotti. He's chasing a fifth best time there of 41.44. He won't get that, and so he's going to slot down towards Zuller's time. See, Zuller's only sixth now at the finish house as Gotti comes up towards the line, and he's going to be slower than Alex Zuller, and so that's not going to be a great ride by Ivan Gotti, who struggled in the mountains on the wheel of Pantani. Now comes home with 41.59 for seventh so far, but this man's going to beat him for sure.
Well, you can see the difference in the two styles here. In fact, I have to say, Il Pirata Marco Pantani has got a pretty low-profile position nowadays. He's obviously done a lot of wind tunnel work this last winter to get his time trialing better than it was before, and his time is pretty impressive. He's not going to beat Laurent Jalabert. He's outside of that time, but he's going to push Sergei Gonchar all the way to the line.
Well, again, we're seeing a man who is fighting every inch of the way here. If he's going to concede his lead in the Tour, he's going to do it in style. Oscar Camazin is the third best time. Pantani is aiming for that, so Gonchar has beaten him now as he sprints towards the line. Pantani is still looking good.
What a great performance by this man, but the course has suited him a bit, Phil. It is only 32 kilometres with a big climb in the middle, and this is going to be a magnificent time trial.
I think he is going to pip the World Road Race champion just on the line. 41-31, third best time for Marco Pantani. Terrific result there for Laurent Jalabert winning, taking 55 seconds out of Pantani. That will be enough to give Laurent Jalabert back the pink jersey. And there he is. It's his turn now to open up the champagne as the race has covered his first time trial stage. And Pantani is now in second behind Frigo in third. Well, it's always an interesting tour when the race leader's jersey changes so many times. It's the sixth different time now that it has swapped shoulders. And Marco Pantani now heading up for stage number 10 in second place from Ancona to San Sepolcro, 189 kilometres. And no real challenges on the course today except that one little hill in the middle taking the riders up to 730 metres. So it's going to be not such a tough day, Paul, but at least the weather's nice.
At least the weather's nice, and still 153 riders left here in the bike race. But there is a breakaway on at the moment. Three riders managed to get clear. Gerrit Klozmer from the Narigari team, Yatislav Ekimov, who now rides for the Amica Chips team, and Alexander Gonchenkov, another Russian rider on the Balan team.
There's a chance to see Ekimov in his new colours as he talks to his team manager here. These three riders have made a very determined effort to get away from the field today, and they have a chance of reaching the finish too.
Strange to see Ekimov not riding in the US Postal Service team. He is another one of the big changes over the winter months. And in fact, there are two Russian riders in this breakaway at the moment, because the man right in front of Ekimov there as well, Alexander Gonchenkov, is another Russian rider. On the front, though, is Gerrit Klozmer, the Austrian rider on the Navigari squad, a man here trying to get himself a stage victory. I saw him earlier on this season riding the Tour de Langkawi over in Malaysia and put in a very good performance there with his team, where they took out three stage victories. But you know, Phil, in the main field there's a certain amount of organisation coming to it as well, because it is one of the rare days for the sprinters in between the mountains and the time trials to get up there and control the race. And I reckon that with Mario Cipollini's red guard, they're obviously looking for a stage win. There's Mario Cipollini. He's got his faithful servant up alongside him there. That man is Giuseppe Calcaterra, who's passing him his helmet. He obviously went back to the team car, dragged it up through the main field, because Mario doesn't like to have those lines at the straps leave. That's why he rides the first couple of hours, in fact, without a helmet.
What a vain chap. Well, he's still a little way from the finish here. Olivier Aschmacher was 157 from TVM, who just went through our screen there. So it looks as though the sprinters have got confidence here that they can bring back the breakaways now and start thinking of the finish. It's still a little way away. As the riders get themselves together, we can get back up now and have a look at the leading group here. And this man here, Glomzer, done a lot of driving in this breakaway here. Ekimov at the back, well, he's an opportunist. He was trying today for a stage win. I don't think it's going to happen now, because the field is taking an interest in the front.
Yatislav Ekimov swapping over this winter to ride for an Italian team, and in fact almost also on that Italian team is another very famous Russian rider, Evgeny Berzin, who we haven't really seen at all this season, Phil, and I reckon may well be riding out his last season as a professional, a former winner of the Giro d'Italia when he took a very impressive scalp, and that was the scalp of Miguel Indurain. But just looking here at Yatislav Ekimov, he's got a fantastic position. This man was one of the best amateur track riders in the world before he turned professional. He held the world hour record for the amateurs, and he really has got a great position on a bike. He looks so cool.
Yeah, unfortunately he doesn't possess a sprint finish, so he doesn't win too many races unless he can use his speed to rip off the front of a bunch finish, which he's done in the past in stage races like the Tour de France. But look at the angry peloton now, a long thin line at the front as the domestiques are driving on, and with the helicopter off to the right there, these two riders know now that life is about to get a little bit more complex as that main field races in. Ekimov not interested in going through and contributing to the pace. It looks as though Glomzer is waving his arms there, saying, well, it's all over, and he's absolutely right, because the field has done it again. Uncanny how they actually come along and capture these riders just before the finish.
But Glomzer realising that it was all over there, so did Yatislav Ekimov earlier on, which is why he turned off the gas pretty soon, because he knows when the main field are decided and they're riding along at 60 kilometres an hour, there is absolutely nothing you can do. And today, again, Phil, it's going to be a day for the sprinters. Moving up to the front, one or two riders trying to peel off, but they're not going to escape today, because I reckon, again, the sprinters' teams are decided, they want to keep it together. But Marco Pantani's team are, well, moving up to the front, and this may well be that they're just going for one of the King of the Mountains points here, because in fact this is Paolo Bettini launching himself off the front out of the pack.
Bettini's gone clear while Casagrande is trying to keep control of the race here. And all of the riders now back in. Bettini made that attack a little bit too obvious, I think, looking at the riders while he accelerates, and the result is they're all up behind him and nobody yet interested in taking up the pace. They're allowing the Seiko Cannondale boys their chance to organise the sprint if they're not careful.
It was Marco Pantani tucked very comfortably in the main field. You can see he's feeling a lot more comfortable than he did over the first week of the Giro d'Italia, because he's always riding in the first 15 or 20 places. That's the safest place to be. If there is going to be an accident, it's nearly always further down the pack, which is why so many of these big leaders always try and ride near the front, even in the sprints towards the end, because if there is a crash and the field splits up like that in one of the corners, you can lose yourself easily a minute before the finish line. So you have to be attentive on every stage of a race like the Giro d'Italia.
A little bit of bumping and barging again going on there as the riders come through to 1 kilometre from the finish. A massive field here. And they don't appear to be going that fast at the moment, but it's hard for anybody now to get through as they enter the final kilometre, and they're very much all together.
Sergei Ivanov bringing him under the banner there, indicating 1 kilometre to go. Pretty funny, because the sign on the banner says sans souci, which basically means no worries.
That's right. And now as Sergei Ivanov opens up the sprint here, he's finding, though, he's got a proliferation of Seiko Cannondale riders. They're trying to bring Cipollini to the line. Cipollini obviously taking this finish very seriously today. And the Navigare boys are also trying to break in. Jerome Blyleven's in that mauve jersey at the back. He's out of it at the moment. He's on the tail of the string, but he's never going to come back from that position, I don't think, as the final lead out for Cipollini before he goes for it. And Cipollini now sees the finish and goes. He's being challenged by Strazza and Arazzi as they come to the line on the right, though. Caranto came very late indeed, but he didn't get it, and Cipollini has got another win, and that is now his 27th win. But look at the speed of the arrival of Ivan Caranto, Paul.
That was unbelievable. Caranto's nowhere to be seen at this moment in time here. Somebody comes up alongside Mario Cipollini there. Cipollini kicks in the gas, and then all of a sudden, from the bottom of nowhere, there's a light blue jersey comes into the action, and that is Ivan Caranto, which is absolutely phenomenal over the last couple of 100 metres. You can see now Gian Matteo Fanini's on the front. He's done the job for Mario Cipollini. Cipollini comes by now and kicks in with his turbo. The fastest man in the world, and he is exceptionally proud of it. And still, for the moment, nowhere to be seen. Then, boom, there's the light blue jersey of Quaranta coming up a lot faster than anybody else. This man, in the next couple of years, is going to be the next great Italian sprinter.
I think you're absolutely right. Well, that was the victory then for Mario Cipollini, win number 27 in the Giro d'Italia, and the second one at this time around. Quaranta getting second, Strazza third, Arazzi in fourth. But in this amazing race, Laurent Jalabert, who is just 0.02 seconds quicker in the overall time than Marco Pantani because of his time trial, still leads the tour. There's the situation. 58 seconds back to Frigo, 1:09 to Gonchar, and 1:13 to Ivan Gotti. And he's in fifth place. Well, now we're facing up to a 125-kilometre, 11th stage from San Sepolcro to Cesenatico. And this again is going to be a little bit of a race, because we're only a couple of days now away from the rest day, and the last week of this tour is the one everybody is already talking about.
Leader in the King of the Mountains, Paolo Bettini, with 28 points ahead of Marco Pantani, and Mariano Piccoli, a former winner of that competition, he's in third.
The field rolling out here and looking after themselves pretty well here, but again they're expecting the sprinters to keep it nicely together as they come down here. And again, Seiko, there's Marco Pantani, strangely paying attention to the front end of the peloton at this stage of the race as he mixes it there. Biagio Conti was the rider alongside him, and the other one is Andrea Leone. Marco would do well to watch out for Leone after what he did to Sergei Ivanov in the second day.
He wants to keep away from too many of the sprinters, because it is dangerous when you come down to the last kilometres like this. But out on the course today, Phil, in fact, Laurent Jalabert got himself a four-second time bonus, so he's in fact extended his lead over Marco Pantani. But for the moment, we're fighting for seconds. In a couple of days' time, we're going to be fighting for quarter of an hour's.
Yeah, absolutely right. We caught a glimpse there of Mario Cipollini. I'm sorry about the little bit of picture breakup we've got here, but the links seem to be a problem today, as again, Seiko trying to wind it up here.
Just on the back of the bike there, you can see a little white thing. That, in fact, is a camera that they're trying out to see just exactly what the run into the finishes look like from Mario Cipollini's team. And that, I would say, is the best team to try and follow when it comes down to the leadouts, because his team is so well-drilled. He goes down to the penultimate rider is Calcaterra, then Gian Matteo Fanini. I reckon if Fanini sprinted over the last 300 metres the way he sprints between 500 and 300, he would be a man capable of winning many sprints in the Giro d'Italia. But he completely dedicates himself to Mario Cipollini. He's there at the moment in second place. Cipollini's in third. And there is Jerome Blylevens in the Chiclamina jersey as the leader of the points competition.
But again, the Seiko boys have got their man with a lovely shot at goal here. He's the second wheel behind Fagnini. But watch out, because Calanta is also up here. He's about five men back at the moment. Also here is Blylevens, who's having a great tour for this man from Holland. Now they fan out, and now the attack starts here. And Cipollini is going to be challenged here. In fact, he's going to be beaten, because Ivan Calanta, who won stage one, has got it right on the line. And in fact, he really did beat well Mario Cipollini there, and Jan Zverada and Jerome Blylevens. I'm not surprised that he's pretty happy with that one, because it now confirms him as a really good sprinter.
Unbelievable. There was no contest at all there. He came out of the pack and he took immediately a couple of lengths advantage over the best sprinters in the world, like Cipollini and Blylevens, and they were not possible, for it wasn't even possible for them to come back to him.
So Ivan Calanta gets his second stage win. He beat Cipollini to third place when he won the first stage, and Zverada and Blylevens the order. But he'll feel a little bit happier today, Laurent Jalabert. He's now 4 seconds ahead of Marco Pantani overall. And in fact, the top seven riders are all less than a minute and a half behind Laurent Jalabert, so he'll have to watch out here. This stage, though, completely flat, 168 kilometres from Cesenatico to Sassuolo. And not surprisingly, the field are more or less together again, and a demonstration once more, Paul, by Cipollini's Seiko boys, I think.
It's amazing the way they ride so closely together. There's around about 150 riders left in this Giro d'Italia, but all the teams try and stay together, especially approaching the finish, so they can talk and communicate together. Cipollini's right in there in the middle of his teammates. There is Jerome Blylevens, and there's the man that everybody in Italy is talking about at the moment, number 95, the great new sprinter on the block, Ivan Quaranta, but he's sitting a little bit too far back at the moment.
But it's true what they say, it takes a couple of years of pro cycling to come through. He turned pro in 96, but he didn't win his first race till last year, and he won four, as we watch Sergei Ivanov here soften up the field for perhaps Jerome Blylevens. But this year, now he's really firing on all cylinders, this young man, and he's now got seven wins under his belt, and of course he's beaten Cipollini, which everybody wants to do.
And I reckon if he had a team like Mario Cipollini's who could really launch him into orbit, he would have won a couple more stages as well. He's a very good sprinter, but he comes from absolutely nowhere, showing us that he doesn't really have an organised lead out. But on the front here, the champion of Russia riding for the TVM squad is really giving everything. He's going to peel off with about 1 kilometre to go, and then once again it'll be up to the red guard to sit on the front and then take the pace and set Mario Cipollini up for the final sprint to the line.
Well, they've got Shiria trying to control the very, very active Ivan Gotti at the moment for that man in the mauve jersey, as he keeps his place, and he's got a good man on his wheel, because Caranta is sitting right on the wheel, almost touched the wheel there of Jerome Blylevens. He'd do well to seek out the whereabouts of Cipollini right now, though, because he does make the mistake, Paul, of having... he's got no team around him, but he seems to always position himself badly.
That's a big problem about a young rider on a team like that. He doesn't have the guys to bring him to the front like Mario Cipollini's team does. Let's not forget, Mario Cipollini's got three riders there at the front of the pack who are totally dedicated to keeping the pace high and keeping Cipollini in third or fourth position. If you don't have a team, you have to fight and stay in position and pick another sprinter's wheel. What he's trying to do today is he's picking the wheel of Jerome Blylevens. Let's not forget, Blylevens has never ever been very far away when it comes down to the bunch sprint, so that's not a bad tactic to adopt.
But if he moved up three men, he'd be sitting on the wheel of Cipollini, and I think if truth had it one-on-one, he's probably quicker than Cipollini, but nonetheless it's the boys at the front who are making the pace now for him, and he's going to keep them whipped up here as long as possible, and he's going to hide in the slipstream. He's five men back, one man has done his job, and now we're heading in towards the last kilometre again, and all that we've got is two riders in front of Cipollini and one stray Polti man setting the pace.
Now it's the Cipollini guard, the red guard, going to the front. Cipollini's lost the wheel of Matteo Fagnini there. That is surprising. He just sat up and let him go by him. He was in the ideal position. 1 kilometre to go to the finish, 1,000 metres. Now that is surprising, because Cipollini now has dropped back several places. He's right on the wheel there of Nicola Minali, a very good Italian sprinter on the Cantina Tolo squad, but he's now dropped himself back to 8th position there, so I think Cipo's really blown it this afternoon.
Well, it must be the new Cipollini method we're watching now, because he's allowed his two teammates to go and pace the other riders towards the line now. And a big lead out they're giving. They don't realise, I don't think, that Cipollini has dropped off the back of the string. And he's going to have to come from afar now, because mixing it too, we saw Nicola Monali just in front, as Cipollini is still a long way down there. And also trying to come through is that mauve jersey of Jerome Blijlevens. A little bit of dodging and pushing and shoving going on as they strike for home here now. This could be a very strange sprint indeed now, as the top sprinters are going to have to come from the back. Blijlevens battling it over to our left. Cipollini has got himself in the middle now. Cipollini is moving through swiftly, and it looks like he's done it. Cipollini has got it on the line, and I don't know if you saw how fast Ivan Karanta came again on the left of our picture. We'll have a look at that in slow motion.
Unbelievable. Cipollini was so far back here. The man in the red moving up into first position there is Gian Matteo Fanini. He's decided he's got to make the lead out anyway. He has no idea where Mario Cipollini is. Cipollini has cleverly moved himself up into fifth place. You can see for the moment, though, there is no Ivan Quaranta anywhere. The sprinter started in third position is Nicola Minali. Cipollini is right there. Now they're starting to come up alongside him, but still we can't see Quaranta. He's boxed in there. That's Quaranta coming up on the right-hand side. He's got to go a long way round all of those other sprinters to try and bring himself up to Cipollini. He's not going to catch Cipollini. He looks across as if to say, well, in a couple of years' time, matey, I'm going to be blowing you away. He's come up to the wheel, but nobody's stopping Big Mario for getting another stage victory here at the Giro.
Well, that was an amazing finish. Quaranta this time being beaten by Cipollini. Blijlevens coming in third place. Overall, no change at all. And still Pantani 4 seconds back. But that might not be the case today, because we now move on to stage 13, and there are the peaks, the highest of them at 1,055 metres, and they come at regular intervals today on this stage of 243 kilometres from Sassuolo to Rapallo, and the day before the rest day as well. And this is a sad sight, Paul, because it's goodbye to the Seiko rider Dario Frigo, who was lying third overall. He's crashed, and we suspect he has broken his left collarbone. That's a very sad exit indeed, because he was having a great tour.
Very sad day for him, because he was lying in third place in the overall standings. But this is just exactly what professional bike riding is all about. It's all really on the width of those tyres, and you never know when something is going to happen. A shame for him, and a shame for the Seiko Cannondale team. And I tell you one thing, there have been a couple of big abandons today out on the course, Phil, because two big sprinters have stopped the race as well. Jans Ferrada has abandoned, as well as Ivan Quaranta, the new darling of Italy, the man they think is going to take over the throne of Mario Cipollini. He had to call it a day on the road to the Giro this afternoon.
Well, the mountains do that to you. This is the group that's setting the pace at the moment, with Gonzalez, Santiago, Blanco is up there as well, and four of them in the way, including Roberto Heras and Richard Veronque. And there's been a crash here. In fact, that looks like Heras in the bushes down there.
Well, I don't know how they managed to do that. He went right behind that tree there. He's a pretty lucky man, because he could have really smashed himself up there. But he's up, and he's been given a bike by his teammate. He's riding away again. That leaves just two riders at the front of this race. The man in the red and white jersey is Santiago Blanco, the Vitalicio Seguros rider from Spain. And on the front is Richard Veronque, the French rider, now riding for the Italian Polti team. Their advantage over the main field, though, the last time check, Phil, was just 29 seconds. But it has actually gone out.
Well, it's not the first time that Chepe González has gone off the road on a descent like that, and taking out Heras with him this time. So both Kelme boys taken out of the breakaway now with 27 kilometres to go. And these two riders have themselves quite an escape at the moment, and are not going to affect the destiny, for the time being at least, of the Maglia Rosa. And so there may not be a rapid reaction from the field.
Well, those guys are not a major problem to Marco Pantani or to Laurent Jalabert in the long future of this year's Giro d'Italia, so they may well be given a certain amount of freedom to stay off the front. Somebody has decided he's going to try and jump clear to try and get across to the two leaders, and that is Nicola Michelli, who's been a professional since 1992. But this is always a crazy thing to do, Phil, on a stage like this, when you do have an established breakaway, to leap across and try and close the gap, because you end up staying in no man's land and using an awful lot of energy, and you've got to be a special rider to bridge a gap of around about 1.5 minutes, especially at speeds like this.
And the Vitalicio rider sharing his drink here with Richard Veronque. Santiago Blanco, he was the rider at the centre of a big controversy between the Bonesto team and the team he's got himself with now, because they wanted to keep him at Bonesto and he wanted to leave, and they won the battle, and he rides for them now, Vitalicio. These two riders still clear. Now, this could be a big return for Richard Veronque if this two-man breakaway survives to the end. And it might do, because they're now coming up to the 15 kilometres to go banner. It is not an easy approach, though the finish itself is on the flat. And Richard Berenc, who got in here, he joined the Polti team after his disgrace with the Festina team, although to this day he's never been proven to have taken any form of drugs in cycling, and he'll tell you he doesn't do that, but everybody has always linked his name to the scandals. A minute and 1 second is the gap. That may not be enough.
With 15 kilometres to go to the finish, and a lot of the work at the front is not being done by the team of Laurent Jalabert. In fact, it's being done by the Mercatone Uno squad of the climber from Italy, Marco Pantani. Pantani at the moment, Phil, although he's not in the Maglia Rosa, is riding like the leader of this event. And this is a very difficult course today, because although the mountains are not huge ones, they're never very much more than 1,000 metres. They are repetitive in nature, which is what makes this course this afternoon a real leg-breaking event.
Well, Pantani clearly thinking long-term here. He worries about the whereabouts of Jalabert, but the other day he was laughing at his tactics. He couldn't work them out, he said. Well, he's sending his own men to the front to keep control of this race, and he's quite prepared to use them. And that's a strange tactic for a man who is not in the leader's jersey, but would like to be. 1 minute, 3 seconds underneath that 15-kilometre to go banner. These two riders, they're happily on the favourite terrain uphill, and that's the thing which might go in their favour.
This is the one thing that might help these riders survive. If it was 15 kilometres on the flat with a 1 minute advantage, I would say they've got no chance at all of staying clear. But the fact is, these two riders are very good climbers. They're on the final climb of the day. And you can see at the front of the main field, Phil, that this is not an organised chase. This, in fact, is Michael Zarabieta on the front for Once. But there was no chase there. They were just riding at a tempo and waiting for some of the other teams to come forward and try and nail them back. But at the moment, the two leaders have still got an advantage, hovering around about 1 minute.
This is Jose Manuel Uria, who's trying to get something going now. He's probably disappointed that his two top teammates were in the breakaway and then finished up out of it because of that crash. And that would be a big shame for them. But this other rider here is Andrei Zinchenko, the Russian rider.
Russian rider was a major revelation last year at the Tour of Spain, where he won three stages. And now he went across the gap there onto the back wheel of Uria just to make sure that he was the policeman. He doesn't want anybody endangering the situation of the breakaway out on the road. The two riders leading is Santiago Blanco in the red and white and Laurent Jalabert in the orange and red of the Polti. Now, there is a small group of riders getting out on the chase there, but in fact, they're not making too much headway over the main field. In the main field today, Phil, there certainly hasn't been a chase at all, as we come now to the banner telling us just 10 kilometres left to go for the two leading riders, and they've got a good chance of holding on because the main field certainly haven't put the hammer down.
Well, they survived 5 kilometres of, it's 1 minute three at the 15 kilometre to go, as they're keeping up their rhythm here, and the riders on the teammates are the two in the lead, right on the front of the peloton, trying to keep them backed off as much as they can. As they're now heading up towards that 10 kilometre to go, Oscar Kammersind again is right there, but isn't quite doing just enough to get away from this field.
Jose Manuel Uria again accelerating. On his wheel, though, is David Rebellin. Now, Rebellin is not going to help at all because he's got a teammate in front, and right in front in first position there is Richard Virenque. He hasn't won a race at all this year. In fact, he's the only rider from the Shame Festina squad who hasn't served a suspension. Alex Zulla was out of the sport for 8 months while he was suspended. Richard Virenque still has a certain amount of a cloud over his head at the moment, and he's going to have to go a long way to prove his innocence because he will come up against the judges from Lille, I would think, sometime in the early part of next year, and then maybe then we will know the true story behind exactly what was going on at Festina.
Indeed. Well, while we've been talking there, two riders have slipped off the front, as Paul said. Rebellin, here he is. And no, these are the leaders now, back with Varenk and Santiago Blanco, who's setting the pace. Varenk just keeping a lookout across the valleys there at the same time as he heads up towards the last 5 or 6 kilometres to the finish. They're being chased now by David Rebellin and Roberto Gambaluri, Italian former world silver medalist in his amateur days. And here they are now. This is the leader, Gambaluri, and followed by David Rebellin. Once a leader of this tour for, I think it was 10 days a couple of years ago, but he didn't run out the winner.
Now the two leaders are on the outskirts of town. This is the town of Arapolo. It's down by the seaside, but I tell you one thing, it's been a pretty hard ride to get here. On the front of the main field, it's the whole of the Mercatone Uno squad leading them out, keeping the pace high. They don't want to let a man like Richard Viron get too much time advantage, which is why they're setting a certain amount of the pace up the front here. Now is the sign that these riders have been looking for, the Sans Souci, Flamme Rouge, Ultimo Kilometro, the last kilometre of the race.
And as they race into the last kilometre, and they're closing down this sector of the Giro d'Italia because it's a rest day tomorrow, but everybody talks about the last week of this tour, viciously hard, with the high mountains of the Dolomites, and this year we mean the high mountains. The riders know then that they're going to have to try and fight off Marco Pantani, who's come through so far and held a very, very high overall place, just behind the race leader, Laurent Jalabert. Now, a little bit of downhill for a little bit of respite, and it's up to these two now to work it out amongst themselves because the others aren't coming back.
This should be a strange sprint because these two guys are certainly not sprinters. They're both very good climbers indeed. And when you've been away for a long time like this, you can always make a mistake. But in fact, it's Santiago Blanco deciding he's going to lead it up coming into the last couple of corners.
And a massive crowd here now as they race into the finishing line. And it looks as though Santiago Blanco is going to have to lead out now. And Virenque is going to wait as long as possible. Now he's puffing and blowing and getting hold of that bike, ripping over the shoulder now of Blanco, making it look very easy in the end. He'll be delighted with this. It's his first win, in fact, since June last year for Richard Virenque. He won a stage of the Dauphiné in France. And Rebellin sprinting clear here to beat Gambaluri for fourth place. And now the main field of coming down the same promenade and being led out as they are now by Andre Teteriuk, as Teteriuk brings them into the home straight now, and the challenge coming from the Vitalico rider Zinchenko, but that was the order over the line. I think Teteriuk got it and he would finish in fifth place, but look at that, Paul, he's got it.
Well, I think the face of Richard Virenque tells everything there. He is so excited and happy to get that victory because he feels that that will admonish a lot of the thoughts that people are having against him. He is come back to the top of the sport of professional cycling, and I have to say at the moment he mustn't be looking very much at these performance enhancing drugs because he's being followed by every police force around the world.
I think you're absolutely right. There's the confirmation of the win, and Terrier got fifth, Zinchenko sixth, and Glomza, who was in a break a couple of days ago, he was there too. But for Laurent Jalabert, he now takes the race to the rest day as a leader by only 4 seconds of the Giro d'Italia, and Sergei Gonchar third. And after a rest day with plenty to contemplate, the race now resuming with the 14th stage of 187 kilometres. There's the big climb right in the middle at 2,500 metres, a massive climb. And this is what it's like to tackle these climbs with David Cassani.
Well, David Cassani, a commentator now for the Italian television, showing us just what it was like in the winter months, because it won't be like that this afternoon. But you get a chance just to see exactly how these men go down these mountains, and this is what is in store for them today. These speeds that the riders will touch on a descent like this are around about 65 miles an hour. So if you make a mistake, you really are going to lose out. One thing of interest is these Italian riders tend to use the front handbrake, the front brake on the right-hand side. As David Cassani comes up to the stop sign here, he lets us know that the riders today are going to face a pretty important day in the Giro d'Italia. As you can see, whenever he comes up to a corner, Cassani's just touching the right-hand brake there. That means that he's slowing the front wheel rather than the back wheel. If you do, in fact, touch the back brake too much and too hard on a descent like this, you really do lock up the back wheel. And all of these riders will today, Phil, take a note of the fact that we're in for a very tough stage.
And this was the rollout earlier. The riders now are facing what is a tremendously hard final week in the Giro d'Italia. Marco Pantani, we know, will be licking his lips because the thought of the mountains. This is the man who's setting the trend today. He's gone clear on the long climb of the Madonna del Coletto, and it's Paolo Savoldelli.
And a man chasing him is Marco Pantani, wearing number one, the pink jersey of Laurent Jalabert, in serious difficulty this afternoon. He's joined here by the leader of the Vitalicio Seguros team, Daniel Clavero. And the other man pulling himself up in there for the Polti team, in fact, is Ivan Gotti, a former winner of the Giro d'Italia. But Savoldelli is doing a fantastic ride today, Phil, out on this course. And this is an unbelievable climb, climbing to 2,500 metres.
Well, he's turned pro in 1996, this rider, and he is now developing into being a very good bike rider indeed. He's still only 26 years of age, as he now continues to ride clear of the field. If he stays away at these sort of gaps, because as far as we know, the pink jersey group is in a little bit of bother back there now, and it looks as though Pantani's decided to go very early today to break the will of Laurent Jalabert.
I think he was starting to get worried about the performance of Laurent Jalabert. Although he has criticised him a little bit in the press, he never really managed to get rid of him on the big mountain stages, and he knows that he has to put some serious time between himself and Jalabert before, in fact, we go towards the final time trial of this Giro d'Italia.
Well, all the cheers were there for Marco Pantani as they were shouting in his ear, as he's now getting clear of the field with two very good climbers around him in Ivan Gotti and Daniel Clavero. And this, of course, is still a long way from the finish on this climb. It's in the middle of the course, the climb of the Madonna del Coletto. And a massive crowd here on what is quite a nice day for the race up in the high mountains in day one.
Paolo Savoldelli is 26 years old. He's had a couple of good wins so far this season. In fact, he won one of the early season Italian semi-classics, the Trofeo Liguria, which in fact back in 1985 was won by a certain Ron Kiefel when the 7-11 team came across to the European racing scene for the very first time. And what a start that was for Ron Kiefel, winning his first European professional bike race. But Savoldelli in fact went on, Phil, to in fact also win the Giro di Trentino, so he's turning out to be a pretty good stage race rider, but I think he too would be pretty surprised by his performance today as he goes over the summit in first place, and we'll now get a chance to see just how far Marco Pantani is behind.
Well, there are going to be changes today too, because Jose Maria Jimenez is in big trouble behind this group. He's also losing time at the moment. He's something like 10 minutes back, which means he's slipping away as a challenger in this year's Giro d'Italia. These three riders, Pantani obviously content to ride with them and not try to rip them apart here. He's using two riders to share the pace with and try and pull away from Jalabert.
Well, that's an intelligent move, because after all, this climb is only in the middle of the course and there's still a very long way to go to the finish line, and Pantani doesn't want to use too much energy at this stage of the Giro trying to open up advantage over men like Laurent Jalabert. I don't feel he thinks the two men with him are a serious danger when it comes to the overall standings, but here is the descent now for Savoldelli, the descent that we saw David Cassani going down through the winter months, and I have to say that Savoldelli is doing a pretty good job here. He's using all of the road. You see he moves across to the left-hand side to get a look at what the angle of these corners is going to be like here, and all of the riders when they go down a descent like this, Phil, they actually try and look at the lay of the land just to see and try and get a guess of exactly how the corner is going to be. This is one of the very difficult hairpin bends on this tough descent.
This is a very, very technical descent. It's very dangerous if you're trapped in the main field because it's narrow and the roads twist and turn and kick back on you. This rider's only ever won six races since he turned professional back in 96, but this could well be his finest victory if he can hang on and stay away. There's still a fair way to go off this mountain. And now we're looking back for the first time at Laurent Jalabert. He's been on the defensive. He's always said he's been keeping that pink jersey warm, in fact, for Marco Pantani. And it looks like he's got himself a pretty strong Mercatoni Uno escort down there.
Looked like Stefano Gazzelli was the other rider in there for Mercatoni Uno, the man wearing number three, the winner last year of the Tour of Switzerland. But at the front of the race, Paolo Savoldelli is really riding an excellent race. The only thing Laurent Jalabert can do now, Phil, is try and survive and make sure he doesn't lose too much time in the Giro d'Italia today to Marco Pantani, and then he can hope to try and get himself a place even higher up in the overall standings on the podium. 3:41, but that is to the time of Paolo Savoldelli.
Now that indeed is true, so he's a couple of minutes off the pace of the new leader of the Tour right now on the road, Marco Pantani. And while Pantani plays on his favourite hunting ground, he's got three teammates back there in Zaina, Garzelli and Marco Velo to look after Laurent Jalabert.
And that is going to be a real pursuit to the finish line, because Savoldelli is still holding on to an advantage over the Marco Pantani group. The last time check we had, in fact, it was hovering at around about the 1 minute 15 mark. But he is riding a great ride here, and he's getting himself down into a very low time trial position. And Marco Pantani, Phil, doesn't seem to be getting too much help from the guys that are with him at the moment. They're also, I think, just worried about limiting their losses.
Well, just like there will be in the upcoming Tour de France, even in these mountain stages this year, you get time bonuses. The small bonuses in the Giro, 12 seconds for the win, 8 and 4 for the top three riders to finish. And, you know, the way this Tour has been going, it's been a battle of seconds so far. The bonuses have proved important. Pantani, though, drives on here, knowing that if he can keep this gap, he's got to be careful he doesn't allow Paolo Savoldelli too much of a lead, otherwise Savoldelli will be the new wearer of the pink jersey. But at the moment, it's going the way of this rider here, Pantani.
Strange situation to see now, these three climbers having to work very hard on the flat to try and pull back another climber, Paolo Savoldelli. The thing about today's climb was it was so far from the finish, and it is turning out to be a very difficult stage because the race got blown to pieces on that climb, and everybody now is trying to play a game of catch-up. They're all trying to catch up the group in front of them, and that will, in fact, for the next couple of days, leave certain riders with pretty sore legs. This is the next group on the road behind Marco Pantani's group, and there you can see Richard Virenque sitting in last position there. the winner of the stage yesterday. In fact, can't participate in the chasing here because his teammate Ivan Gotti is in the group up the road.
Indeed he is, but here's this young man here, Paolo Savoldelli, trying desperately now to hold off one of the greatest climbers in the world, or the greatest climber, I suspect many of you will say, in Marco Pantani. He has taken his move very early on. He has taken a lot of risk on the descent to increase his lead slightly over that chasing trio. And now, surely, he's not going to throw it away. There's a little bit of news for him. I only wish I knew what they were saying.
He keeps calling up his team manager. The team managers in a lot of these international races now, in fact, have televisions in the car. That way they can keep an eye on just exactly what is happening further down the road, and that keeps them really up to scratch on how they can change their tactics. And what he wants to know is just exactly what the formation is of the group behind him on the road, and it's pretty easy to see. It's Marco Pantani, Ivan Gotti, and the man from Italy there, the man from the Vitalicio Seguros team, is Daniel Clavero.
5 kilometres from the finish for the leader, and I think he is going to hang on here because the gap at the moment is just a tad under 2 minutes. We might get absolute confirmation of that in a second as the clock starts to count. Savoldelli, with 5 kilometres to go, has a real chance here because he's not being chased by the sprinters. There's nothing so organised as that. Just three riders trying to escape Laurent Jalabert.
But despite the hard work that's been done by this group of three riders, Phil, they've not really managed to reel any time in at all. The last time check was 1 minute and 30 seconds to the leader on the road, Paolo Savoldelli. So he's actually made a pretty serious operation today, and he will find himself moving quite high up in the overall rankings.
Well, it's 40 seconds since he passed under that 5 kilometres to go sign. These two riders are working well together. Clavero has dropped to the back again. And now, as he races in towards the finish, Savoldelli here is going to be feeling good now. He's Italian, of course, and the crowd are shouting his name, and he's winning the hardest stage so far of the Giro d'Italia. Even Pantani is looking a little bit under pressure now because this is not his favourite terrain anymore. He's on the flat road, and he's trying to get as many seconds as he can over Laurent Jalabert and prevent the man up front getting too much of a winning margin.
Savoldelli still at the front of the race. He'll be feeling a lot more confident, and in fact he's going a lot faster. There was a confirmation. It still is 1 minute and 30 seconds to the chasing group of three riders, and he has done an excellent job today to pull himself up the overall rankings of the Giro d'Italia. But it has been a long, hard chase for these riders who are in the group behind, the group of three riders with Marco Pantani, because they are not in their favourite terrain, and one or two of them will have pretty sore legs and backs tomorrow for having had to use slightly bigger gears than they would normally use on the mountain passes.
Back into the hills again tomorrow. We've got some big climbs coming the way of the riders, so a big effort today. You might pay for it tomorrow, but Savoldelli right now, you know, he's not just thinking of the win of the stage now. I think he actually is hoping he can get the hold of the Maglia Rosa, the pink jersey, and for an Italian, that is everything in cycling. This man is still riding very, very strongly indeed, whereas these three, and 135, in fact, is saying on that board, Paul, so it's looking as though it's a winning margin, that.
It certainly is. In fact, he's stretching it out all of the time, and that's quite bizarre because he's got three guys chasing him. He's riding a superb race at the front here, and he's stretching it out. There's confirmation of his advantage, 1 minute 35 seconds. So he will be climbing up, I think, Phil, to second place in the overall standings with this win.
Well, it'll depend where Jalabert finishes, but as he comes towards the line, Jalabert's last time check was 3 minutes 10 seconds behind him, so that's a fair way back. But now this man is going to enjoy his seventh and greatest victory of his career as Paolo Savoldelli gets the victory, and now he has to wait and see if he's done enough to get the Maglia Rosa. I don't think he has, but it's going to be pretty close here. Because here comes the riders now for second, third and fourth with Gotti, Clavero, Pantani. And it looks as though Clavero is going to have to lead out. Now, Pantani's not a renowned sprinter, but I do believe he's going to have a go for this, taking on Clavero and Gotti. And it looks to me as though he's going to get it. So Marco Pantani finishes second, Clavero's third and Ivan Gotti is fourth. 147 is the gap. Here's the main field coming in with the pink jersey. Not the main field, but the pink jersey field. 327, that's a lot. But this is the rider who's got his best victory, Paolo Savoldelli. And it hasn't quite got him up into the pink jersey, by the way. We'll have those for you in a second. This is the stage result, though, with Clavero finishing third, Gotti fourth. Overall, Pantani leads by 53 seconds over Savoldelli. And the legs continue to shake. Take a look at the finish here. The 15th stage going up to 1,144 metres and 143 kilometres the race distance. In itself, not a long way. That 53-second margin to Savoldelli. Gotti is there now, previous winner of the Giro d'Italia a couple of years ago as well. And this stage now taking the rise from Rancanigi to Aropa. And right at the top of the mountain is where we finish. There, further down, the overall situation, the gap's beginning to open. But there's a chance with people with only 6 and 7 minutes deficit to come back on a stage like today. And the first man out on the attack again, a small group of riders has got clear, and this rider here is Roberto Petito, himself a recognised climber, trying to get clear of the group.
But he's hoping that he can try and move himself up in the rankings, because their best placed rider, Dario Frigo, had to abandon the Giro just a couple of days ago. And that, in fact, was because he was taken out with a broken collarbone. This is Orlando Rodriguez, the Banesto rider, on the front there in the white jersey. He's trying to get himself a great breakaway this afternoon. But the main field feel completely controlled by the Mercatone Uno squad. And on the front, the 37-year-old Massimo Podenzana, former champion of Italy. And what a great domestique he's turning out to be.
That's right. He won the Tour of Italy championship, the national championship rather, on a couple of occasions, but he's not a big winner, but he is a great helper and stage winner of the Tour de France as well. Right, now this continues here. Orlando Rodriguez here trying to push on a little bit over the cobbles, and I'm just wondering if Banesto and Seiko are trying to launch attacks here in favour perhaps of a later move by Alex Zulla or indeed Savoldelli.
Well, it's surprising because Banesto came to this year's Giro d'Italia with Jose Maria Jimenez as their number one favourite, and he got completely blown away, which is rather surprising because he prepared properly for the Giro d'Italia. He was expecting to ride well, and now I think he'll have to go away and formulate plans to try and perform better when he goes to the Giro. But there's a problem at the back here.
And that is Pantani. Now he's just come out of the back of the pack there. He seems to have done the repair himself because the mechanic was a bit late on the scene. But now, how many of his team have waited for him, I wonder?
Well, it took a long time for the team car to get right up to him. What had happened there, Phil? In fact, one or two riders have been dropped off the back of this group because there is a splitting up happening at the moment. And the Mercatone Uno car wasn't there as quickly as the neutral service vehicle. But Marco Pantani now has a new spare wheel in the back there. So it must have been a flat tyre. The team manager right up alongside him. In fact, he's going forward to talk to the rest of the team and say, come on, let's get ourselves organised, because Pantani now is at the back of the race. He's 15 seconds at the moment off the rear of this peloton.
Well, he's got two men back waiting for him. Looks like a few more have dropped off the back of what is a drastically reduced peloton here, as the riders at the front also getting off the front.
Now, this is a bad time to have a flat tyre, because we're just 8 kilometres from the finish of a mountaintop finish today. We climb up to 1,100 metres. This is the moment when Pantani pulled off. He was sitting in the front of the main field there. He gets to the side of the road and he's immediately, what a real professional. He can see it's a back wheel. He takes it out himself, and that will speed the change when the neutral service car gets there. And they're there pretty smartly.
I must say, it doesn't seem to be showing any signs of panic at all. Up comes neutral service. Pantani having a little bit of a wrestling match. His chain looks as though it was jammed there. I'm not sure it was a puncture, you know, Paul. In fact, it was a jammed chain, because in the sprockets, he's got it out himself.
In fact, it wasn't. He never changed the wheel at all. He's up there now with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 riders from his own team. And they're trying to pace him on. But the big problem is there are attacks going right off the front of this main group at the moment. So he's going to have a pretty hard time getting on. This is an unfortunate time to puncture. And it casts me back to last year in the Tour de France, where, in fact, Jan Ulrich leading the race had a puncture at the bottom of a mountaintop finish.
And we all know who took advantage of that. His name was Marco Pantani. But right now he's got his whole team around him. He's only 15 seconds off the central body of the lead pack here, but there has been an attack at the front and riders have gone off the front, and we'll find out who they are when our motorbike cameras can get up there. But this looks like we've caught a glimpse of the first one there. I think that was Zinchenko from the Vitalicio team, as Stefano Gazzali here dropping down, done his pacemaking to help get Marco Pantani back through. Here is the other end now, is an attack. Gabriele Massaglia, he moves over as Zinchenko starts the attack at the front.
Zinchenko, a superb revelation at the Giro d'Italia last year. He hadn't won a stage or a race in his professional career, and he ended up winning 3 stages of the Vuelta a España. A very good rider. He probably doesn't know that Marco Pantani is right at the back of the race, having a very hard time. They're joined here by Marco Della Vedova, the Lampre rider there, who's just trying to get on the back of this very fast train. At the front of the main field, though, you can see Laurent Jalabert is very much present, as is Paolo Bettini, the leader of the King of the Mountains. But it's looking here as if Pantani's having a hard time. He can't follow his own teammates through.
Well, this is amazing. He didn't panic, or didn't seem to panic, when he did his wheel. He got his teammates and they started to take him back up. He's settling back in his rhythm now, I think, as he goes round riders who are in trouble here, including Jose Jimenez. We just passed him. He looks to be in trouble again, and you may have seen Pantani take a good look at him as he went by.
This is a very difficult moment for Marco Pantani. He wasn't able to follow the pace being set by his teammates, who must be riding 20% above themselves. This is Marco Velo wearing number 8 just in front of Pantani, but up at the front, the big attacks are now starting to come through. They're all trying to jump off the front. This is Roberto Heras, the rider from Kelme, trying to get away, looking at the stage victory. And in fact, taking off in pursuit of him is Laurent Jalabert, and the man right behind him there wearing number 143 is Ivan Gotti, the man who is currently lying third in the overall standings.
They actually went clear when Pantani was having his trouble, when the little group scooted off the front. Whether they saw Pantani swing over to the right or not, I wouldn't have a clue. But anyway, they're going to make it tough for him now, because let's go up to the leaders. A quick glimpse there, the champion of France, Laurent Jalabert, is up there again. Considering that Jalabert has always said Pantani is going to win this race, Jalabert has proved a superb competitor in this tour.
Well, that man just getting blown away there was Enrico Zainer, the penultimate teammate for the Mercatone Uno leader Marco Pantani. But he's still having a hard time following his own teammates. It's really been an explosive effort. While at the front field, the race is certainly starting to blow apart. Another attack here coming from Nicola Michelli. But still, we have one man up the road. That's Roberto Heras.
So the mountain is now blowing them all apart here. Meanwhile, from the back, trying to cut his way through to the front, it is very reminiscent of the climb of Jan Ullrich when he punctured towards Les Deux Alpes in the Tour de France last year. But to me, it looks to me as though Pantani has got control of this race, and the weather's an awful lot better as well. But up at the head now, Jalabert is giving it just about everything. He wants our camera motorbike a bit further out of the way.
Well, Marco Velo was the last teammate there for Marco Pantani. He's riding very much on his own now, picking his way up through what of the remnants of the front group now. A lot of riders starting to get dropped, and this is why it is very difficult for Marco Pantani to pick his way through the rest of this group. Still at the front of the race, though, it's Roberto Heras doing a very good ride, a winner of a stage in the Tour of Spain. And now you can see Pantani going through the town on the cobblestones. In fact, picking up pace now, getting himself onto the back of a group. He'll try and recover a little bit and get his composure back, but there's still just 5 kilometres left to go.
A magnificent crowd here. 22 seconds behind, they're saying Pantani is, so he's flying up this mountain, you know. Although we can't actually put it into perspective at the minute. As the riders continue the climb, this is still Michele who started this other counter-attack, as Pantani's hooked himself up to the back of this little group now. Now, is it a recovery moment and then continue on? Because this is the man he wants, Jalabert.
This is a kind of climb for Jalabert. It's not too big a major mountain, and he's actually managed to put Ivan Gotti into difficulty. So Jalabert has gone off in lone pursuit of Roberto Heras. And in fact, Pantani recovering pretty well. He's got himself onto the back of another group of riders here, while Jalabert is burning up the road trying to catch Roberto Heras, who's still the lone leader. And in fact, there he is, just around the corner. There is Heras. Jalabert moving up into second spot.
Well, knowing that, and he's on him, and knowing the quality of Heras, this is a fine piece of riding by Jalabert. We often think of him as a non-climber, but he does have his good days, and he's on one of those right now, because this man is stamping on those pedals. And here Pantani, remember, he gave them all a head start on this climb. He's been knocking them off one by one, but he still hasn't quite got up to the man ahead yet.
Laurent Jalabert is such a tough bike rider. These are the kind of climbs that suit him. These climbs are much more like the climbs of a race like Liège-Bastogne-Liège or the Flèche Wallonne, the kind of races where he excels. But this man has been put into difficulty today, which again emphasizes the fact that when you want to win a three-week tour, you have to have lady luck on your side. You have to be attentive. That's Savoldelli there, and he's getting left behind. Marco Pantani started the climb 15 seconds behind everybody else, and he's picking his way up slowly towards the leaders. He's dropped Savoldelli. Savoldelli was at maximum there, and in fact, he's pulling himself a lot closer. There's the gap between Jalabert and Gotti. That is 6 seconds, and it looks to me as if that is Gotti there. So in fact, Jalabert can't be too far around the corner.
Right, and Savoldelli's actually got onto the back wheel of the Parate there, so he's hooked on. As we see this man now trying to storm and produce a real surprise in the Giro this year, taking time out of Pantani on a mountain. There's Michele, here is Ivan Gotti. My goodness me, he's covered in sweat and water and all sorts now, as now he's got onto the back of these two, so there can only be two men at the most in front now of Marco Pantani, and he's going again.
Unbelievable. Fantastic riding. He never panicked at all. He came up to the wheel of Gotti, took a little deep breath and then accelerated away again. He won't know what the situation is on the road, though, Phil, because for him, it's been total confusion. He doesn't know who's in front, who's behind him. He's just riding as fast as he can because he knows there are still riders away because there aren't any lead cars in front of him. Michele now has responded to come up to the wheel of this man, and right in front there you can see, in fact, that looks like Heras, because round the corner we'll still be looking for Laurent Jalabert.
So two riders we estimate now left in front of this man in pink who was giving them all a real start today. Now he's giving them all a real demonstration. And in fact, it's Jalabert he's come up. I thought we caught Heras lower down the slope. It's Jalabert, and now he's in the lead. Jalabert looks across and he's still got an acceleration.
Yeah, but will Pat Tarney know that there's nobody left in front of him? He's happy now that he's caught up with Laurent Jalabert. He would have seen the faces of the majority of his contenders as he came up through the main field. This is the moment when he caught Laurent Jalabert. Jalabert looks across and Il Pirata accelerates, but the French champion has still got the possibility with a few pedal strokes under his belt there to get onto the wheel of the big climber.
Well, these boys are battling it out now. Ivan Gotti is in the middle of a tornado here in the shape of Marco Pantani, who's now gone clear. Pantani looking to see where Jalabert is, thinks he might have him and accelerates. Wow, he almost came in the television then as he goes round our camera bike and accelerates. And I'm not sure Jalabert can answer that.
Well, he waited until he saw the gap there, and as soon as he saw that he put Jalabert into difficulty, he accelerated away. And one of the other clowns turning out for this tour of Italy, because everybody wants to get themselves on TV, but nobody is going to get themselves on TV as much as Marco Pantani, because he is flying away. He's getting caught there in absolute chaos. All those motorbikes will be getting a severe reprimand tonight because they all want to get a picture of Marco Pantani in the pink jersey blowing this race apart on a climb that shouldn't have been that difficult for men like Ivan Gotti.
Well, Pantani is free as a bird now. Ivan Gotti is going to continue to try and follow if he can, but he's going to be really pushed now to stay with it. As he starts to fall away, this man is responding to the crowd now. He's come all the way through the field. He's seen every one of his riders. He knows what their condition is. He's put them all in difficulty, and now he's racing towards a stage victory here.
The man from the Balan team on the left-hand side of Gotti there was Gilberto Simoni. He now is riding a very high ranking in this finish towards the summit of the climb. But, you know, today, Phil, it is going to be a superb, superhuman performance by Marco Pantani, because he started the climb with a deficit of 15 seconds on everybody else. And while he was at the back of the race, the attacks were going on at the front. And it's been a very difficult climb for him. But the true champion that he is, he never panicked. He rode himself back into the race, and now he's riding himself back into a stage victory.
And Jalabert, you have to admire his performance today, because he suffered on these mountains and yet he still remains a serious challenger in the Giro at this stage, with only a few stages left to go. As Pantani again reminds them all, he is the man of this tour for sure. He continues to accelerate, and Jalabert continues to hold off the rest of the moment. Behind is Gotti, Clavero, Savoldelli, Michele and Gilberto Simoni.
These are not super time gaps. 16 seconds to Laurent Jalabert, 26 seconds to Ivan Gotti. But you can see now that he realises he's pretty close to getting himself a stage victory, and a stage victory with the pink jersey of leadership on his shoulders. But he looks to me, Phil, as if he's tired a little bit towards the summit of this climb, because this has been a very hard ride to pull himself back into the lead.
Well, the adrenaline must have been pumping at the bottom after he stopped with a jam chain in his gears. He sorted it out himself. This rider always looks pretty cool on a bike. He never seems to show his suffering, but he can suffer in Laurent Jalabert. He's going to finish second today, though, to Marco Pantani. They've both worn the Maglia Rosa, but tonight it's going to look a lot safer on the shoulders of Marco Pantani. Not a long stage, but done a lot of damage, because Jimenez has lost another huge amount of time today on this climb. Passed and dropped at the bottom by Marco Pantani, no longer a challenger overall. Pantani comes up to the finish, and this will give him a bigger lead than ever in the Giro d'Italia tonight. His effort is over, but what a great ride by Laurent Jalabert, because he could actually see Marco Pantani crossing the line. As Jalabert, the champion of France, he races on the Spanish team, comes over the line, and he's not that far behind, about 21 seconds back.
Well, Savoldelli also trying to survive here, but the man who's going to lead them over next is Gilberto Simoni. There is Ivan Gotti as well, but this has been an incredible performance by Marco Pantani, because he was the man way at the back of the race. He never panicked, he recovered, and he's pulled himself back into the bike race. If it hadn't been for Marco Pantani, Laurent Jalabert would have got himself a big mountaintop finish. This is Savoldelli coming up to the line. He has lost 49 seconds, and you can see the damage that this short climb has done.
And you can see how tired the riders are too, as they almost collide as they come across the finishing line. A desperate finish today in the Giro d'Italia. And the winner has increased his overall lead in this race in his favourite playground, of course. Here's the little battlers from the Kelme squad who keep on making the moves and never quite putting in the results. So we look at the face now of a very tired Marco Pantani, but a very happy one indeed, as he now strengthens his grip on the Maglia Rosa in this year's Giro d'Italia. He now won the stage here from Jalabert, 21 seconds, 35 over Simone.